Hello, everybody, and welcome to Final Girl, part of SAFeCon, part of Gehenna Games, amazing weekend of super awesome happenings. Did you like that? Is that good? How about what I'm actually supposed to say? Maybe let's do that. We should let everybody know that Save Against FearCon 2020, or SAFeCon 2020, is the Bodhana Group's first online convention to kick off the charity season and raise money to use tabletop gaming as a therapeutic tool. If you had absolutely no idea what was going on, that's the big explanation. But I figure that if you're here at 9 o'clock on a Saturday, you might have already learned a little bit about this. I want to say thank you to Legendary Pants! That's right, Legendary Pants, for sponsoring SAFeCon 2020. For more on panels, virtual games, and actual plays that are running all weekend long, you can get your badges and tickets on thebodhanagroup.org. SAFeCon 2020 is powered by Gehenna Gaming. How was that? I thought that was pretty good.
I'm impressed.
Thanks. I appreciate it. Hey, I'm Brian Liberge. You might know me from my work, making gaming products at BeerStarGames.com, Cobalt Press, Raging Swan, maybe some of my panels, often with the Gamer Assembly. Maybe you love Gehenna Valley on Monday nights, coming back very, very soon. That's me. I'm Brian Liberge. I do a bunch of those things. I'm a talky guy with games. It's great. Woo! And my pronouns are he and she. Let's meet the rest of our players, because I'm just facilitating tonight. We got a bunch of players. We're going to play a fun, great game. Aid, tell us what's going on.
Me? Oh, gosh, I got to go first. Okay, yeah. I am Ashley, or Aid. You can find me here on the Gehenna Gaming channel on Mondays. I'm also in the Monster Hearts 2 game. You can find me on Twitter. Maybe Brian will add our Twitter handles later. I don't know. All I do is play games. I'm not like a cool GM or like I don't make games, but I do like to play them. So if you ever need anyone, here I am.
Hey, that's good. I like that. And then, so that's Aid, who is on my left, according to, Twitch, and on my right, we've got Rosie. Rosie, tell us about yourself.
Hey, I'm Rosie. If you hang around the Gehenna Gaming Discord or Monday Night Monster Hearts chat, you might know me as Regular Size Mom. I love to play RPGs, and that's why I'm here. So, hope you all have fun.
Cool. I love it. That is super, super exciting. We love this stuff. It's such a good stuff. And now, Bob is, of course, where is Bob? Bob is on my bottom left.
I'm Bob. I think I'm probably the oldest guy in the room here. I've been gaming for a very, very long time. And incidentally, gaming has kind of always been a form of therapy for me. So it's been a very important part of my life. You can find me at Gen Con blabbing my mouth about how to be a good GM. I spend almost all of my time GMing. So the fact that I'm playing in this game is really a testament to what a great facilitator and GM Brian is. The fact that I'm actually playing in a game. If you need to find me online, ask Brian. He can find me.
Nice. I love it. I'm very excited. And down in my bottom right? No, right? No, I was right the first time. Right is Natalie. Tell us about Natalie.
Hi, I'm Natalie Pudim. I'm a professional game master with Charm Person Games out of Baltimore, Maryland. You can find me streaming here on Gehenna and in other places.
Woo! Oh, that was amazing. That was great. One thing that we don't have up on the screen this time is, if you're used to watching me stream, I usually get a little square that shows you like some of the other stuff that we're looking at. We don't have this just the time, you know, just suspend your disbelief, put it in your head, you'll be fine. It's really not have anything interesting. We've got some playing cards that we're using. We're going to tell you what they say. And we've got some like a little digital scratch pad for notes. So don't worry about that. You're fine. There's nothing to talk about. You're okay. Whew. All right, let's get started. Mandatory stuff. We got our group of players. Oh, speaking of which, to make this extra fun, I've only played this once before.
It'll be a fun time.
Oh my gosh, and I played it on GG Live, so it was great.
It's true.
And it's actually, what I've liked about it is it's really, really quick and easy to learn. So while I am, like, sort of stressfully looking at the official rules, I probably would be fine if I just made it up. We would get through
the
game.
I wouldn't know the difference.
Most of you wouldn't. But I want to give people at least a good, solid thing. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to do casting. Casting is this great, amazing thing where we come up with the characters that we're going to play. The game calls them the Victim Squad because most of these people are going to die. When the final girl, generally there's only one survivor at the end. And it might be a girl, might not be a girl. That's okay, that's cool. But we need a bunch of people, so there's lots of options. Keep you on the edge of your seat. You won't know who is going to die and who is not going to die. So this is what we're going to do. That's the sentence. I'm missing a word. Okay, great. We're each going to create two characters, but before we create two characters, we need to come up with a general premise. And the general premise doesn't really have to have the killer completely tied down, but we're going to learn a little bit about the killer, and then we're going to let ourselves flesh out the killer as we go. And when I say flesh out the killer, what I really mean is that it's whatever is killing people. So the killer could be one person. This could be like a slasher movie where there's one person slowly going after anyone. The killer could be a threat, like a virus or zombies. It could be a lot of different things. All right? No, we're not playing Dream Askew. The game probably hasn't been updated since Thursday because on Friday the con started.
I figured I'd throw it out.
No, good job.
In case it was updated. I think it wasn't, and that's okay.
Yeah, and I think we've said the game enough. It's the final girl. And if you're watching live on Twitch, it's actually, they did update the name of the, what's happening. It says the final girl there. Right? Yeah.
Yeah, they did. Yeah.
How many people have I lost so far? 14? Great. I will like a small, intimate audience while I'm running games. So let's create our killer real quick. This slide right here, this is going to be the killer. And this is what we're going to do to create the killer. Oh, and the setting, of course. Killer. It's going to be a killer setting. Oh, I love it. You love it too. Okay, let's see here. So this is what I want to do. I want to start with three things for the killer and two things for the setting. I think that'll be... We're going to switch it up. We're going to do two things for the killer and three things for the setting. So if my players will go to the deck of cards, right? And what you're going to do is you can see my cursor floating around. We're using a digital deck of cards. Y'all can't see this. You're going to left click on the deck and drag it down to the bottom of your screen, and then it'll show it to you and just you.
Why is this card face up?
I think someone clicked on it maybe and then didn't.
They're all face up. Oh, God.
And then didn't drag immediately. So this is what we're gonna do. We're gonna shuffle.
All right. I'll go last.
Okay. I'm gonna try again. Okay.
Me too.
Okay.
All right. Now everyone can essentially do this at the same time. Oh. We don't have to take turns.
Okay.
If we all click and drag.
Okay. Cool. How many cards did we need?
Just one.
Just one. Okay.
Okay. Great. So now we're going to reveal what cards we got, and we're going to go in the order of best card first. So, I got a 5.
I have a 7.
Okay.
I have a 2.
All right. Who's that
wow.
ace?
I have an ace.
Oh, and what else have we got?
I have the 2 of hearts.
Oh, okay, great. Uh-oh. So, ace obviously goes first, and then 7, 5... hearts goes before spades, right?
Sure.
I don't remember. We're going to say it does because I love Bob and I want Bob to go last. And I love...
No, I got the two.
Oh, you got the two?
No, but I want to go last.
I mean, if you really
I love
want me to
Aid,
go last.
And I want Aid to go last.
There you go.
I'll do that to make you happy.
No, I'm just trying to show my love for everyone at the same time. Professional gamers! All right, so the person who got the ace, it's up to you. Do you want to establish something about the killer or the setting?
Setting.
Okay, great. This can be anything. This can be like the big idea. So if you wanted to say school, yacht, apartment building, give us what do you want to do?
I've been thinking about this.
Yeah.
In a certain movie lately. I think it should be space.
Oh, cool. All right.
We're on a spaceship or space station.
Yeah. Now, we did do consent forms ahead of this, and I don't remember anything about space, but just real quick check-in with everybody. Nod if you're okay with space, because space is definitely a thing that some people are not okay with. Okay, great. Space it is. So we're going to be in space. And now I think the seven... who got the seven again?
That's me.
Okay. I got everything screwed up. So what do you want to set up? The last, another piece of the setting or a thing about the killer?
Let me go about the killer.
Okay. And the killer can be like a lot of different things. It doesn't necessarily have to be something that dictates whether it's a single person or a individual or a mob, but you can say stuff like this. So you can say mob. You can say, I said last time, they're always wet. So you can really give them a little something that can be pretty vague if you want to, and we'll continue to build on the killer as we get more scenes with them.
Okay. So we're not just stuck with the two things that we
That's right.
are starting with.
That's right.
Okay. Technology.
Okay, great. So the killer uses technology?
Uses technology? Is technology? I don't know.
I would like you to pick.
Oh, you want me to?
I think we should choose one of those things. Is technology or uses technology? Because I think that is important. And they're both pretty vague.
I'm going to go with uses technology because I have a little concern that if I say is technology, it's going to like zero us in a little too quick.
Okay, cool. Cool. I will build off of setting because I was the five. And I will say that not only are we in space, but we have four themed biospheres. Won't that be fun?
So you mean like...
So wherever we are in space, that's like a it's got sections to it. And there's four very distinctly themed ones.
Okay.
Does that sound cool?
Yeah.
All right. I like it. Who's next? I think it's Rosie.
Okay. Let's go with a detail on the killer.
Okay.
They always knock. Polite.
Wow. That's both... amazing and awful. Always knocks. I'm already horrified.
Yeah, me too.
I'm not happy. And
Candygram.
Aid, that gives you the final one for setting.
Yes. Let me know if this is lame.
Yeah.
This space, whatever that we're on,
yep,
is like very far from any other like home.
I love it. Isolated.
That's not lame at all.
Yeah, I think that's great. Isolated. All right.
That's a good way to concisely say what I was trying to say.
So we are gonna build now 10 NPCs. That are on in this setting, and these are the 10 NPCs. One might be the killer, or the killer might be completely separate from them. So let's do this in the reverse ping pong order. So Aid was last, so let's start with Natalie here. So we're going to name the person and give them just like a very brief description, like Carl, the space janitor who loves baseball.
I'm going to say Ainsley, the nerdy scientist.
Okay. And you, would you go, and we can share the typing. Are we all staring at the thing?
Yeah, I'm looking at it.
I can be.
Okay. No, it's all right. You
need to type the name.
I don't know how to spell Ainsley, and I figured you could do it for me.
You're just being lazy.
I am a little bit. I also don't want to insult somebody here within our group if, like, Ainsley is their favorite name ever, but it's probably too late for that now.
Actually very small for me.
We can make it bigger. We got
marking on that.
Yeah. All right. Bob.
All right. Let's do Charles, the burnt out first officer.
Great. Charles, the burnt out first officer. That's fantastic. Here, I'll jump on this.
Oh, so you're going to spell Charles.
Okay, you do it then. I didn't see you typing, so I was trying to help. Maybe you got scared of typing. I'm not sure.
All right, so I'm just going to have to do this just to be...
It's Charles with a Z, everyone at home. Charles with a Z. Very important note.
Well, that's how the kids spell it in the future.
That's how the kids spell it? Who said it was the future? It probably is. We have an isolated space thing.
I mean, actually, let me make his name correct then if we're talking about way in the future. His name is at Charles hashtag.
And a harsh...
Oh, I'm God. Just kidding.
Wow. Rosie, we've why don't you go next? Give us a...
We're going to say Frank, the janitor.
Frank the janitor. All right. I'm going to let you type that so I don't get in trouble. Okay. And then I will do... let's see here. I will do Yuri, the cranky engineer. Okay, Aid, you are up.
All right, I am going to do, hello, typing. What should their name be?
I don't know.
Let's do Sawyer. And they are going to be the, over-eager, new blood guy.
All right, yeah, the new person, new, the
like
rookie.
I guess he could be, a biologist or something.
Yeah, love it. That's fantastic. Now, do you want extra pressure and we can slingshot so you get to do two in a row? Or?
I can come up with another one.
Oh, okay, go for it. We're going to slingshot.
Okay. This is going to be Barbara.
Nice.
And she is the motherly nutritionist.
All right, nice. The motherly nutritionist. I love it. All right, and I am going to then go next, and I am going to make when we're going to make a really future name. Xena. Z-E-E-N-A. Xena is the veteran engineer. Oh, we already have an engineer. The veteran.
You don't have a captain yet.
Yeah, we'll make them the captain. What do they call the captain on Deep Space Nine? Because they don't go anywhere. Is it still the captain?
Still the captain.
Oh, that's weird. All right. Xena, the veteran captain. All right. That's Rosie now.
Okay. I'm thinking, because I was going to go with a Z name.
I'm sorry.
Do a Z name. It's the future. It is the future. Everyone's name starts with Z.
That's right.
We're going to go with Zed, the stowaway.
Oh, fantastic. Yes, Zed the stowaway.
Why would you stow away on him? I guess maybe we'll find out.
We'll find out.
We'll find out, yeah. All right, so only two more people on this space station. Okay. Bob, what do you have for us?
I have for us Dave, the extremely literal AI.
Excellent.
Ooh.
That's fantastic.
So do they have like a robo body or is it just like in the ship?
Dave is the ship.
I love it.
Is the ship. Okay.
And one more for Natalie then.
Okay. Let's go with... I was going to do a captain and then my backup was a stowaway.
No!
Disaster. Great minds.
Yeah. Let's do. Greta, the trigger happy weapons officer.
Oh, nice.
That won't go poorly at all.
Yeah, but every space horror thing has to have that person. It's like written in a regulation somewhere.
All right.
Oh.
Yep. What?
Sorry,
what's up?
Question.
No, it's okay.
Dave, the extremely literal AI, is that also our holodeck, or is that a different?
Well, I would assume if we have a holodeck, that Dave's got a lot to do with that.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I think maybe whoever plays Dave will get to help flesh Dave out a bit. So in this game, we take turns playing different characters, and you may never play the same character twice, because often people are trying to grab people who they've never been as we move through the scenes. In the first three scenes, we're going to do introduction scenes. And in these scenes, even though someone will play the killer, no one dies in those first three scenes. And we're going to slowly introduce each one of those characters that we just made. So let's do that right now. Okay. So real quick, I forgot to ask this. I think I'm the only person who's ever played this game, right? Has anyone else ever played this game?
I have not.
I have not.
I love this so much. We are such a bunch of noobs at 9 o'clock at night. It's the noob 9 o'clock hour. I love it.
Well, as if we're going to do it right, but we're going to have fun no matter
what. I played this once. It's fine. It's fine. Besides, we're the end of the night show. Everyone's drunk. It's fine. Not us, and we don't condone your drinking, obviously. But we know what you're doing.
I brought tea instead of scotch, and now I'm sad.
Well, we'll have a break where you won't get scotch. Let's see here.
The same color as the tea.
No one has to know.
Oh, that's right. Don't worry about what I just said.
That's right.
Yep. We're just going to have to space some of these people out a little bit. That's all. I forgot. So, here's what we're going to do. We're going to do an introduction scene. Someone else has to frame the very first scene for me, and I'll play the killer the first time. Does anybody want to frame the first scene? Think of it like a movie. So this is the introduction to a movie, and we're going to introduce four characters during this scene. Do I have a volunteer? As we are all playing together. We'll all get a chance. Oh, no, I liked the trick that we did last time, especially since no one's volunteering. Even though Natalie's really happy,
I was waiting to see if anyone else wanted to.
Okay,
all of us are ready to jump in.
Oh my gosh, well, I was going to make Aide do it, and since Aide's excited to do it, because what I'll do is, I've set us up on the Twitch in the same order that we see each other on the Zoom, except I just minimized the Zoom like an idiot. All right, I can fix it super quickly. I've gotten really good at fixing this, unfortunately.
We're professional streamers.
We are professional streamers, which means we make the same mistakes all the time.
We'll get there.
Professional streamers. We make the same mistakes all the time. Why isn't this working? Oh, because I'm an idiot. Sorry, I'm not an idiot.
You're not. Don't talk about you like that.
I know. That was a thing. Match the title, otherwise find the same type. What's that all about?
PC load letter.
Sorry, this gives me a little more time to think about.
Yeah, think about what I...
this scene.
Even though I wish, I don't know why this isn't working like I want it to work. Yes?
Maybe.
It's weird. It's being weird. Oh, I'm so sorry. All right, you know what we're going to do? We're going to take a quick 5-minute break, and then we're going to start the first scene. I'm so sorry about that, everybody.
We promise.
But I don't want to just have you sit here in silence while I'm trying to figure everything out. So we will be back soon. Okay, right, Brian? Right. So are you going to play the break thing? Yeah, play the break thing. Here's the break thing. Oh, you're still talking, though. Why are you still...
Thank you.
Okay, we're back. Thank you for your patience, everybody. I am very, very, very silly, and I unbroke everything. And in the process of unbreaking everything, I clarified some stuff. So we're so good at this game now. It's amazing. So like I said, we're going to do the introduction scene. In the introduction scene, we are going to introduce four characters played by Aid, Bob, Natalie, and Rosie. I'm going to play the killer, but I'm not allowed to kill anyone during the introduction scene. I'm just sort of playing everything that isn't them. So I'm playing sort of the environment and the mood, except for the things that are set in that very first opening shot. So, Aid, let me ask you this question. Would you like, since we're doing the introductions, to hear which characters are going to be in the scene and then set it up? Or do you have a really good idea for the setting scene and then we'll pick characters based off of that?
I think I have an idea of what kind of scene I want to do.
Awesome. Yeah, so hit us.
If it's not good.
Okay.
It's like my disclaimer all the time. All right. Anyway, I'm imagining a scene where it is morning, according to all of the clocks that are set. I don't think it's easy to tell on this space station when day or night is, but I think there's just some sort of established schedule. So it's morning, and awesome. It's like everyone or whoever wants to be is in the like makeshift little like cafeteria that they have
okay.
in their area having breakfast.
I love it. Awesome. So that sounds like fun to me. So let's pick our characters for the first scene then. And the last time I played this, we just fought about it instead of doing any sort of official picking order. So I like that. So if you are not me, is there a character you would really like to play and establish for us in the very first scene?
And yes.
Okay. Wow. Aid still. All right. What's going on?
I know what I want, and it's Sawyer, the overeager new biologist.
Okay, cool. So we do track, for a reason that I don't remember, but I'll remember later as we continue the game, who played the character first. So would you add your name, like in parentheses, next to Sawyer
yes.
in our notes so we don't forget? Who else?
If we're in the cafeteria, we have to have Barbara, the motherly nutritionist.
All right, so great. Natalie, go ahead, you grab Barbara. What about you, Bob? Who do you want to play?
I'm torn between Charles and Dave. Let me go with Dave.
Okay.
The AI.
Dave the AI. And Rosie, that gives you all sorts of choices to pick from.
I'm happy with that because I want Charles.
Oh, great. So we've got Sawyer, the overeager new biologist. We've got Barbara, the motherly nutritionist. We've got Dave, the extremely literal AI, and we've got Charles, the burnt-out first officer, here in the cafeteria of the space station. Which biopod is the cafeteria in?
I was thinking that it'd be cool if it was kind of like the center meeting point.
Nice, I love it.
These things.
So yeah. it's like the office part.
That's how I imagined it in my head, at least.
I love it. That's great.
Yeah.
All right. So, Aid, since you set the scene for us, I think that, okay, little shout out to the chat, especially if you're watching on YouTube. Your big dad just found out that his and Rosie's neighbor is fostering puppies.
Woohoo!
So,
I love puppies.
Now we all know. Good job, neighbor. Everyone is excited. All right. Aid, since you set the scene, I'm going to make you have the first line as well to get us started. So we zoom in to the cafeteria in space.
So I think right on, like, 7 o'clock, right on the dot, Sawyer like walks through the door. It's probably too early for some people, but this is on his schedule exactly when he's supposed to be here, so of course he's exactly on time, and he has way too much energy, and he strolls over to wherever the food is at.
Do we have like those meal replicators where like you can type in and get whatever meal you want? Like it just
I think
Are we that level of sci-fi?
I don't think it's that level yet. Yeah. I think the food here is not that great. I think Barbara does her best too with what she's got. But yeah.
I think we're somewhere in between freeze-dried fake scrambled eggs and food replicators.
Yeah.
Somewhere in the middle of that.
Yeah. So Barbara is standing behind.
and Sawyer is just, you know, he doesn't care. It's whatever. It's crappy space food, but and he's super ready for the day. And he's got this like giant smile on his face as he approaches the food and Barbara, it sounds like, and says, "Morning, Barb. How's it going?"
"Good morning, Sawyer. Protein cubes and vegetable cubes today. They're spinach flavored."
"Ooh, I love spinach." And Barbara would know that literally every meal he's always just like, "I love whatever it is."
Yeah. And I think Barbara spoons out like a big like clump of like jiggly like tofu looking cubes and a big chunk of like green cubes.
Oh god. and I think Sawyer just like holds his plate and he kind of like wiggles it a little bit and everything kind of jiggles and he's like, we see him kind of stare down at it and says, "Well, maybe I'll get used to the texture one of these days."
"Remember, eating your vegetables is important. You don't want to get, you know, vitamin deficiencies out here in space."
"Yeah, right. That's fine. Thank you, Barbara. You keep on keeping on." And he like does a little finger gun and like
enjoy
goes
your breakfast.
"Oh, thanks." Goes to sit down at the table, probably by himself.
Charles is going to sort of walk past you, and having heard what you said, he's going to say, "You never get used to a kid. It's the same old cubes every day. Doesn't matter how they taste, they're cubes. Always cubes." And then he's walks past you to get his cubes and probably burnt coffee, and he's just kind of humming some kind of nursery rhyme under his breath.
As Charles gives his grumpy food routine, Dave's voice pops in. His camera's everywhere, and you don't ever have a notification of, you know, which one of these his AI is currently inhabiting, like which camera he's looking through. There isn't a red light or anything like that, so it's kind of always a mystery where he is. But when you say the comment about, you know, same old cubes, he has to pop in and say, "Charles, you know very well that these things are made new every day. They can't be the same old cubes."
"Dave, that's not what I meant."
"And if you examine closely, you'll see that they are not all cubes. Some
Thank
of them
you, Dave.
Are rhomboid based, others are various polyhedral shapes. We do try to keep it interesting. Barbara says that an interesting visual presentation of the food assists in the motivational aspects of eating. You do
just
well to take an example from Sawyer."
Charles just kind of slams his tray hard. He's like, "Thank you, Dave."
"You're very welcome, Charles."
Oh,
and, then from Dave's point of view, I guess we have like this, you know, uncomfortably long breakfast. And as you're seeing on the screen, you're just looking through the different security camera viewpoints. One staring over here, but it cuts. You're seeing it from another angle. And you see the hallways.
He's watching.
Dave is always watching.
Great. Go ahead, Nat.
I think Barbara, I think that it's very early. Like, normally the cafeteria rush is at, 8. They just open at 7. So Barbara comes over, I think slips Charles, a salt packet. It says, "It's very important you keep eating your vegetables, Charles."
He rips it open and puts it on the veggie cubes and says, "Bless you."
I think Sawyer probably sees this out of the corner of his eyes, but he is new. He's not going to say anything. And he's like, in his head, he's like, "Maybe one day I'll get some salt packets. But for now, I'll eat these cubes." And wonder, does it really count as eating if you don't chew it? It's all just squishy. And I think he eats very quickly. Because you got to get those vegetables.
Nice.
And also, he's very busy because, as the new person, I'm sure he's gotten stuck with all the tasks that no one wants to do. So he, like, probably inhales his food, like, within, like, 5 minutes. He's just, like, going for it.
Mm-hmm.
And, I think maybe he, like, coughs a little as he eats a little too fast. And the rest of you probably notice this because there's probably not that many people, like you said, in the cafeteria yet.
Okay.
But he's fine.
Yeah.
It's okay.
Dave's making a note of this in Sawyer's medical file.
Eats too fast. And I think he actually literally says that, like, as he, like, drinks some water or whatever, he's like, I'm okay, don't worry.
Is Charles sitting with Sawyer? Did you two sit together?
I don't think they did.
No, I'm pretty sure Charles is sitting where he can watch Sawyer, just so he can feel sorry for his optimism.
So this isn't like a time
we're not near each other.
I think Barbara comes out to wipe down some tables, even though they're all clean. The kitchen, the cafeteria just opened.
Mm-hmm.
But she kind of floats near Sawyer. It's like, are you settling in okay, dear?
Yeah, it's great here. I'm super excited to be here.
Very exciting being in space, but you need to sleep and take care of yourself.
Yeah, I mean, of course. I'm in, like, tip-top shape. They don't let just anyone on here, you know?
Correct.
But I appreciate that. Like, really, it's nice to have someone looking out for you while you're up here.
Of course.
I'd like you all to know that I'm always looking out for all of you. You'll never be alone because I'm here.
Thanks, Dave. And I think Sawyer leans into Barbara, like, really close and, like, whispers to her, like, very quietly, like, is he actually always watching us?
I'm not so good with all that technology stuff. I try not to think about it too hard.
Okay. Thanks. And I think Sawyer, like, looks at his watch or whatever and is like, I gotta get going. I've got so much to do. I gotta go. And he, like, lists off all these crappy tasks.
See you at lunch?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. The cubes are tomato flavored.
Wow. Amazing.
So it sounds like the cafeteria is a little bit bigger. It wasn't built for just 10 people. Do we think that over time, just the way the technology has gotten, the space station has needed less and less people? Or is there a lot of people on here we just don't care about as part of the movie?
I think I like the less and less people. Like, this mission is kind of a, like, to whatever, like, space force.
Your cat has muted you.
I know. Okay. My cat keeps doing that. I think that whatever space force exists, like, this is now a low priority mission, and funds and, like, people have been diverted away, so it might just be, like, us 10.
Mm-hmm.
I think I like the idea of us 10 in a place that was built for more people.
Great.
I really like that, and that fits nicely with the isolation setting. Uh-huh.
Exactly.
Awesome.
For specificity, it's a 9-person mission.
Yeah.
That's true.
One of them is not on the manifest.
One of them is the
and
manifest.
One of them is Dave.
That's right.
Oh, right. I forgot
that. Eight.
I forgot the character I made up.
So, which is great. So as your character, actually, whose name I just forgot, tell me who the character
Sawyer.
Is. Sawyer is going to leave. Of course, this space shuttle has those doors that automatically open when you get near them, as long as they're not locked, and automatically close once you're away from them. So inside the cafeteria, all the doors are automatically shut. As you begin to approach the door you need to exit through, you're not nearly close enough to set it off yet. And you hear a sound you haven't heard since you've been on board. You hear a sound of a single solitary knock on the cafeteria door. And it sort of echoes in the room. And if anybody had been close enough to that door, it should have automatically opened. This is a public area. There's no reason for anyone to have to knock, never mind just once. What does everybody do?
I think Sawyer kind of stops in his tracks and looks very confused, because like you said, this door should open. No one should have to knock. I think he walks towards the... I'm imagining like a little panel next to each door where you could lock it if mm-hmm. you like needed to. And like double checks on the panel, like this door is open, right? And I assume he sees that it's not locked.
You tell me. I'll let you decide.
Okay, I think he sees that it's not locked. And in mm-hmm. fact, as he approaches the door to look at the panel, I think it opens, like assuming that he's like wants to go through.
Great. And there's nobody on the other side.
That was weird, he says as he kind of like... He says it loudly so that anyone in the cafeteria can hear him as he like turns to look at the others.
Don't overthink it, kid. There's a reason this mission is sinking.
It's probably just a small meteorite on the hull.
Charles, are you aware of some malfunction with the station that I have not been... made aware of?
I don't mean literally sinking. No, not literally sinking, Dave. Not literally.
When it comes to vocabulary like that, Charles, it would be good if you could be a little bit more specific.
I will try.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
You're welcome.
I just think that's a perfect line to end the scene on in transition. Unless you want, did you have a good punch at the end there, Rosie?
No, Charles was just going to kind of choke on some coffee.
That's great, too. Who doesn't want to choke on coffee and end the scene there? I love it. It was really cute. So what we're going to do now is we're going to see, we're going to talk about established relationships and establishing relationships, which is why we spread out our notes a little bit further during the break, even though no one can see that. I'm just explaining what I've done. There are three types of relationships in this game, and both players have to agree on them for them to stick. There's friendship, there's rivalry, and there's screwing. You choose friendship if you both think the characters are friends and have had a friendly relationship leading up to this. You choose rivalry if you think both characters are rivals, and you choose screwing if the two characters are actively in a sexual relationship. And things can change to screwing later on. So does anybody feel like that scene was good enough to establish one of those three relationships?
I do.
Yeah?
But I want to consult with the last scene's owner of Charles.
Oh, yeah.
So that interplay in between Charles and Dave, I think that could be indicative of either friendship or rivalry. Because I take it like Charles has been on the station for quite some time. So he knows Dave very well, and Dave knows Charles very well. So to what extent is Charles bothered by, does he hate Dave, or does he actually, you know, is it like a you know, Bones and Spock type relationship, or is it something else?
He doesn't hate Dave. He's just very tired of Dave. Okay. So let's go with friends. They just need a break.
Okay,
great. So on both our Dave note and our Charles note, you want to write friendship in the other person's name. You know, just take responsibility for your character. Aid, what was your idea?
I think Barbara and Sawyer are friends. What do you think, Nat?
I think so.
Great. So on both, make sure you write friendship with the other character's name.
I also think there could have been some sort of implied relationship with that salt.
I was thinking the same thing.
Okay, yeah. Do you think they're screwing?
Are they more than friends?
Yeah, we could say they're screwing.
Okay.
All right.
It's not public, but like...
Yep. So that's Barbara and Charles?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so we want to make sure that notes get on both characters' sides. And do we feel good there, or do we think there's more that we need to do? All right, great. So we are going to move on. Bob is going to be the person who sets the scene. Aid is going to be the killer, which means you get to control everything else. But you don't get to kill anybody yet. It's still an introduction scene. And the rest of us are going to choose four characters that have not been chosen yet. Bob, would you like to hear the characters first, or do you have an idea for the next scene?
How do we feel about flashbacks?
I like flashbacks.
Okay, so I have an idea of flashback as to the day that they launched on the mission.
Oh, okay. So people who aren't angry, but have still been here for a long... Well, not the person, the angry person from the last scene, but still people who have been here for a while.
Right.
Okay. All right. Does everybody... I think we can do that. Are we all cool with that?
Yeah, I think that's fantastic.
All right, cool. Yeah, we're all doing this together. So, who is not Aid sees a character they'd love to establish as has been here for forever and they want to play.
Frank. Oh. Frank.
Frank the janitor.
Before I did.
Always been there.
All right, great. Go ahead and write your name next to Frank. You're the first person to play them. Bob, since you got robbed, do you have a secondary favorite?
Well, I will go the person who's probably likely to be the second most burnt. I will be Yuri the Cranky Engineer.
Excellent. Yuri the Cranky Engineer. I love it.
I'm between Xena or Greta. Were you looking at either of those?
I would... Oh, well, okay. Ashley's the killer.
I don't get to play any of them.
But I will grab Greta if you grab Xena. How about that?
Okay, sounds good.
All right. So, Bob, where are we? Is this like the conversation in like the launch position as we're going out to
Yeah, I think that's where we're... That's a good place to start because it gives us sort of like a compressed time frame. Like it's a scene. If it's going to happen, and then we launch.
Okay, great.
All right, so, Yuri's strapped in his engineer's position, which is sort of the back of the compartment where he's got access to all his knobs and dials and buttons. Frank is in the seat closest to him, being designated, at least by the higher-ups, as the quote-unquote least important person here. Who else? Greta and who else are here?
It's Greta, Xena, the captain.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah.
All right, so yeah, let's open it up with Yuri and the captain getting into it about something.
Okay. T-minus 5 minutes to launch. Are we ready, Yuri?
No, we are not ready, Captain. I must tell you again, I have not primary ignitioned the power generator. It is nuclear powered. We must start chain reaction first.
The commandant of Space Force is watching. Get this. You should have started this an hour ago, Yuri.
It's not my problem. He is impatient. Nuclear reaction take time. Must be careful. Cannot be rushed.
How long do you think this is going to take?
I don't know. 4 or 5 hours.
You have 20 minutes.
What? We're all strapped in. Are we seriously all strapped in 5 hours early?
You did not go to bathroom first?
I thought in space you just peed.
No, I don't want to clean that up.
Aren't all the suits equipped for peeing? That's like an astronaut thing.
They are all... Don't stop messing with Greta.
What?
Yes, Greta, of course your astronaut trousers can absorb liquid. Of course they can. Feel free, let it fly, as they say.
Okay, then. That's what I thought.
Okie dokie. So he pulls out a TI-85 calculator. It's a relic from the past, and he starts crunching some numbers on it. He's beeping and booping all his numbers and his dials and whatnot. And what's Frank thinking? What's going on right now?
Frank is... he's worrying that even though the trousers can absorb a fair amount of fluid, eventually the sponge can't hold everything. 5 hours can be a while. And then they have the flight. So he's doing some math and hoping that Yuri is just messing with the captain.
Frank, you're looking nervous. Do you need calculator?
No, I hope that you can hold on to that and do what you need to do with it. But can't the computer help you with that?
Oh, possibly. But do we trust machines? I mean, there's reason that engineer is on spaceship.
Well, yeah, but of course we trust machines. We're on a spaceship.
Have you met Dave?
No.
Okay, you're going to see him when we dock, okay? Dave is okay. But I not say I trust him.
Who is Dave? Did we send someone forward ahead? I thought that I was to be the forward operative on this mission.
Who are you, the captain again?
I'm Greta, the weapons person.
Oh, okay. No. Is Dave? Dave is computer on big thing we dock with.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
Science person calls biome machine or something like this.
Great. Yeah, that's cool. You just keep launching us. They're my Russian ally.
Okay, definitely going to be, Captain says 20 minutes. I believe I have 17 to go. And with that, he presses a button right then and there that triggers the launch.
Oh boy.
I think Zeta like cracks up laughing as she's like pressed back into her seat and looks over at Greta like, you know, fighting gravity, like fighting the G-forces, like just like Pegasus 4, huh?
Yuri's howling some Russian version of Geronimo or something like that as he cackles in the back seat, sort of turning around, fighting against the G's so he can see the look on the captain's face.
I think the captain is kind of a thrill seeker, and she is into this.
I think Greta's just shaking her head and just, like, swearing. It's just like, in Pegasus 4, we had more warning of the surprise attack.
Greta, question for you. Did you use special trousers?
No. I have full control.
Of course you do. Hey, hang on. Everyone get ready. We're about to decelerate.
He hits the accelerator that punches it up to about 9 Gs.
Don't pass out.
This is fun part.
Commandant's gonna kill me and keep me on this backwater mission forever, isn't he?
I take care of you, Captain. Don't worry.
He says, no, okay. I will take care of you, Captain. Do not worry.
It is good, because I don't really care who takes care of anyone. I take care of ship. Is my worry. Listen, you all be glad and thank Yuri when you don't have to deal with Dave so much.
I think that's a wonderful line to kill the scene on. What do other people think?
Yes, I do want to do one thing.
Oh, right. Yes, please.
So I think as Yuri says that, everyone's wearing like their space suits, so they have like a helmet or whatever. And like in your like helmet communicator thing, you get this briefest moment of like static, like And then you hear the voice of who you would assume is like the ground control voice, like who was the like point of contact for the people on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And when they speak, it's very broken up. It's hard to understand fully what they're saying, and you just get snippets of like, Captain did unidentified, and then that's it.
Whoa. All right. That's crazy. That's intense.
It's just solar flare. It's just solar flare.
Great. That does calm theory.
Addendum to that addendum.
Yes, please.
The sort of nursery rhyme that we heard Charles humming.
Oh, no.
Is
yeah.
what it fades out in the static.
Oh, I don't like that. I don't like... All right.
You love it. That's what you do.
So I feel like we need to add... Is that? Do we feel like we need to add the nursery rhyme to the setting or the killer? Because obviously this is a recurring theme. Does this have something to do with the killer? Mm. Or do we think this is just has something to do with... We're going to reveal it to be part of the setting for some reason.
The killer makes more sense?
Yeah, I think the killer makes more sense as well.
It's creepier.
Yeah.
I agree.
All right, we're going to add nursery rhyme. We'll all discover together what that means. Well, isn't that awful? I think we definitely established some relationships during that scene. I think, at least for one, that Greta has a rivalry with Yuri. Is that fair to say, Yuri?
He seemed to be trolling her.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I will write that on the Greta sheet. Who else has one for us?
I think Xena and Greta have a friendship.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Absolutely. They've got a history together. Who else has one?
Even though Dave wasn't in the scene, it's clear that Yuri and Dave are probably rivals.
I don't have a problem with that. The last person to play Dave is Bob, so Bob, are you cool with that?
I'm fine. I argue with myself all the time.
All right, great. So go ahead and add that. Bob, would you add that to both for me, please?
But of course.
Okay. Frank, do you think that was enough to set up a rivalry with Greta, where Greta is already sort of, or even with Yuri, where there is, Yuri's got sort of the short end of the stick, and people are working to make Yuri's life harder, or not Yuri, Frank's life harder, or do you think it wasn't good enough?
It's the start of a mission. Mm-hmm. I can definitely see it as becoming more so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we can.
It's up to you.
Rivalry.
Yeah, who do you think would makes the most sense?
Greta.
Okay. All right. Yeah, let's do that. Let's do a rivalry with Frank and Greta.
I also think Xena and Yuri have a friendship. I think that. Xena gets Yuri.
Yeah, what was the name of that mission that you shouted?
Pegasus 4.
Yeah, they were on Pegasus 4 together.
Okay.
Oh, great.
All three of us were on Pegasus 4 together.
Oh, jeez. That's interesting. Okay, we came out of that differently. So...
Yeah.
Cool. All right, so this is going to be the last introductory scene next. Bob, you are going to set... No, I'm sorry. Natalie, you are going to set it up. Bob, you are going to play the killer. Two of us are going to play the last two remaining NPCs, and then two of us will play NPCs that have already been established if we think it makes sense to add them to the scene. So, and I generally like to have many characters in the scenes until they start dying. I think that's more fun. So we,
generally, he says, as...
Yeah, I've played this game so many times. So we've got Ainsley, the nerdy scientist, and we've got Zed, the stowaway, to establish. Oh, this could be...
I have an idea for a location that would be good with both of them.
Okay, what do you think?
I think we need to do one of the biomes. We haven't seen one of the biomes
yet.
We
haven't, no.
And I think there's a biome that's just called Harvest, and it's sort of like fall air and like lots of like food, like it's like a farming, but it's like constantly in harvest.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's like super accelerated.
Yeah, so we have an accelerated farming biome, and
but
somehow
to make
we
the food laughed. It all gets processed into cubes.
It all gets processed into cubes.
Well, that is upsetting.
Oh my gosh, right? It's going to be so painful to harvest the food.
Because, like, the mission started with all these people, and now there's, what, 8 of us?
Yeah. Well, 9, but yeah.
But we still need to turn it into cubes, because if these fail, like, we need to have enough food for a year saved up. So.
Right.
Yeah, at some point, scientists realized the most efficient way to preserve, package, and store organic materials
cubes.
In some sort of cube shape.
Yeah. Cubes. You know? We've known it for 1,000 years, so... Does anybody love Zed? Or
I love Zed.
Okay, you be Zed.
I would love to be Ainsley.
Okay, you be Ainsley. And that means that... Because, Bob, you're the killer? Did I say that?
I am.
Okay. That means that Rosie and I get to pick our favorite person who's already been established each. And you should try to play a character you haven't played. Let's see here. In the Harvest Realm.
I added a little detail about it onto our
great
settings slide.
I love that.
So that we don't forget.
I think I'm going to grab Frank.
Okay, I would like to be Dave.
Okay, great.
Yes, Dave. I love Dave. Is this scene 3?
This is scene 3. It is our introduction scene. I don't remember if we're supposed to track the duplicates, but let's do it anyway. So you and I are both going to write our name in scene 3 somewhere on that. Just in case we need that, because I can't remember. All right, cool. Ainsley, do you want to start us off, since you are the newest character? It makes sense to be able to speak immediately in a scene.
Yeah, sorry. So we have Frank and Dave here.
Frank and Dave, and Zed and Ainsley.
And Zed, right. Okay, so I think Ainsley is, I think she's working. She's doing some sort of work, and she's got this, like, I was going to say clipboard, but more high-tech would be like a tablet. She's got this tablet, and she's probably standing by some crop field area. And I think she says, "Hey, Dave, when did we plant these potatoes?"
"Yesterday, at 300 hours.
I'm just thinking, like, who's planting potatoes at 3 in the morning? And
space.
Space. And she kind of, like, crouches down, and she's, like, in this, like, I'm just imagining there's, like, a layer of dirt on whatever ground there is, obviously, because you gotta grow these potatoes. And you see her kind of take her stylus, tablet stylus, and, like, poke. There's, like, this little sprout that's coming out. And she says, kind of out loud, assumingly to Dave, but whoever else is around is welcome to overhear. She says, "I'm surprised that this has germinated so quickly."
And I think Yuri will come around the, not Yuri, Frank, the janitor, will come around the corner at that moment, and he's writing what looks like a Segway, but what it is in reality is the lawnmower for the harvest area. And he sort of, like, comes out from behind a tree, and he goes, "It's a space potato." And he starts mowing the area closer to you.
And I think she kind of stands up, gives Frank this kind of, like, look, and she's like, "Yeah, it's a space potato, but it's also just a potato, and usually they don't germinate until
insert correct time here.
Yeah, but we've had this harvest biome since the very first day. It's one of the first things that the biologists and nutritionists got up and running. And I mean, they've been growing fast since then. That's kind of the point, right? They grow fast, they cube fast.
Yeah, but if they grow fast, and doesn't matter how fast they grow, if they don't have the right nutrition.
The process has been accelerated due to increasing demand.
Increasing demand? We've got fewer people on this ship.
Everybody loves potatoes.
Oh, Nat, you're muted.
I think in like some like berry bushes behind you, you guys hear some rustling.
I love it. I think Dave says something increasing demand. We hear Ainsley is like, increasing demand? What are you talking about? There's fewer people on this ship. And then like right after she says that, you hear this like rustling in the bushes, and Ainsley will like turn around and be like, who's there?
Nobody.
Frank will get off his mower and pick up his giant loop of keys, because even in space, the janitor has a giant keys. Loop of keys.
Space keys.
They're space keys, but they're very important. And just holds like one of them out and be like, you come out of those bushes, because I get bored real easy.
I think you guys hear like of like a panel being lifted up behind the bushes.
Yeah.
And like a metallic clunk as like someone drops into like the tunnels below.
Frank, go check that out.
Yeah, no, that's cool. I'm definitely qualified for this. It walks out behind the
Dave,
bushes.
Dave, help him. Can you see what that was? Who that was, rather? What does Dave see?
Probably a great time for some knocking. I'm thinking like three clangs on the overhead piping or something like that with the irrigation system. Can't tell where it's coming from, just reverberates through the room like clang, clang, clang.
Dave is confused and kind of runs a diagnostic of the area to try to figure out what that is, and is concerned that they can't find anything.
Well, we got dropping below and we've got dropping above the gap, but I don't know. I don't understand, because gravity is on, clearly.
And I think Ainsley heads over to communications panel phone thing.
Yeah.
And kind of I'm imagining like this intercom thing, and she like dials in the number for security and is like, hello, I think we've had an incident here in Harvest.
I'll jump in as Greta, since I'm the last person who played them and they weren't originally in this scene. So Greta goes, all right, describe the incident. I'm on my way over.
There's someone beneath us and someone above us. There was like knocking on the roof, and I think someone might have hidden themselves in the service tunnels underneath.
Well, knocking on the roof is generally a space thing, like things hitting the outside of the space station. That's normal, but why do you think there's a person?
Because they said that there was no one there, and then it sounded like they dropped into the tunnels, and I think as she like finishes saying that, she like turns like away from the panel and like shouts across the way to Frank, like, Frank, go check it out.
Frank says, okay, yeah, I'm gonna take my keys and go down this ladder to the tunnels that I know a lot about. You could hear him kind of like getting quieter, so he's clearly doing it.
I think, like, underneath there's, like, you know, like, where the water drains from, like, everything. Like, it's, like, bilge tunnels. And you come down and you see that there's been, like, a little cot set up and, like, a tiny little hot plate and, like, a place to eat. And, like, sitting on there is just, like, this, like, I think maybe, like, 18-year-old with like hair, like greasy hair in his face. It's like, hi. And I think importantly, this room has like no camera in it.
Oh. Like, hey, Ainsley. Tell Greta it's just a stupid idiot.
I think you hear, like, very faintly through, like, the ground and, like, the open tunnel. You hear Ainsley say over the intercom, Frank says it's a stupid idiot. I don't know what that means.
Great.
I could use a little more description.
But before, let's end the scene before Greta gets there. Bob, was there anything else you wanted to do, or are you satisfied for this scene?
I think a final three clang.
Okay, just
moment
happens again,
echoing through the room.
Great. All right, let's see what we learned about our new characters and our established characters that got to play. I did it again. I'm gonna fix it while y'all talk about characters. Okay. It's gonna be fine.
Okay.
Friendship, rivalry, screwing.
I think Zed has a rivalry with Frank.
Frank, the janitor? Yeah, we just set one up. It's the first person in a long time who Frank outranks because you're a stowaway. I think that's more than enough motivation.
And because of Zed, Frank has now added yet another area of the ship that he has to clean.
Yes. Yep. Yeah, I didn't even know about this room.
It didn't need cleaning before.
Ugh. And now he needs to look under all these floorboards.
I gotta see if there's more roofs. Oh, that's awful. I love it.
It's pretty unkind.
I think Ainsley also has a rivalry with Frank.
Really? With Frank?
Yeah.
Why do you feel that way?
I think she felt like he was, like, minimizing her experience as a scientist.
Okay. All right.
But if it's only one-sided, then we don't have to...
No, I like that. Let's play that. Let's give him a rivalry. He has so many rivalries, this guy. Let's give him a rivalry with Ainsley. Maybe he's become bitter with all science since working here, really. Like this. Science isn't that hard. I could do this.
Well, maybe he has no one to talk to because they're all busy doing their other things.
You think? Yeah. Well, maybe we'll get him a friend before this is all over. Let's see. Anybody else? No? Okay. Let's see here then.
Oh, wait. No, I have one more. I'm sorry.
No, it's all right. Continue.
I was reading something else. I think that Ainsley and Dave are friends.
Ainsley and
Dave. Because I think that Dave is very helpful and Ainsley is happy too. Even though I think she probably understands the nuances of his very literalness.
Okay. I love it.
Makes sense. Cool.
All right. So let's make sure we get that on both their blocks. Now, we're going to do some fun stuff. The new scene type we're doing, now that we're all out of introduction scenes, is we're going to do a first blood scene. It's a unique type of scene that happens after the introduction scene, and it's when the killer finally gets to start killing. Now, Natalie, you're going to play the killer. And the killer frames the scene, starting now. So, Rosie, you'll get to frame the scene next time, but we no longer separate those out. I'm sorry. I feel ya. I'm right there with you. I didn't get to frame the scene either yet. Every player who is not the killer is going to choose a character. Now, normally we would start with characters who have no relationships, but
we love relationships.
I don't think we have any. No, we don't have any. Oh, that's fun. So, Hold on 1 second here. If there are no characters with zero relationships, then we're going to play the characters who have the fewest relationships. So I think there's some that only have one. There's Zed the Stowaway. There is Sawyer, the overeager biologist.
I think they're the only ones with one.
Okay.
There's a couple with two.
Charles has two. And yep. Ainsley has two.
Barbara
has two.
Zena has two. Okay, so first things first, we'll do the one persons. Does anybody want to play Sawyer in Sawyer's last scene?
I'll do it.
Great. And does anybody want to play Zed in Zed's last scene?
I'll do it.
Okay, great. So now, Rosie, we get to pick the other two people from amongst the people who only have two.
I want to die.
Yeah. I just want to make sure that... Okay, yeah, they're all going to die. Yeah, because it's the first blood scene, so everyone in this scene dies. Alright, so let's see here. So it's Ainsley, Charles, or Barbara. Oh, that's hard.
I feel like either Charles or Barbara needs to live to carry on their relationship.
I'll take Ainsley.
Okay. I will take Barbara, because I kind of want Charles to have a chance here. So it's Ainsley, Barbara, Zed, and, oh my gosh, I forgot the last person, Sawyer.
Yeah. Forget Sawyer.
I don't know.
Well, everyone tries to forget him because he's so upbeat and perky, and they just want to pretend he's not there.
So this is scene four. Scene four, Brian. Cool. All right, so Killer, you get to set the scene, and you're going to kill all four of these characters before the scene is over, okay?
Okay, I think it's like a slight flash forward, like just a little bit.
Okay.
And there was an old brig put into this space station.
Yes.
And there was more people.
Great.
And I think Zed is locked up in it.
Awesome.
And I don't know why the other characters are there, but I'm sure you can find reasons to be there.
Oh, yeah. I mean, and Barbara is there because Barbara is bringing this poor, under-nutritionalized child who has been eating nothing but solid food this whole time since they've arrived. needs to get some cubes in their system to make sure they have the proper nutrition. So I know why Barbara's there. The other characters can also enter as the scene progresses, but does anybody else want to be there and have a good idea?
I'd like to enter midstream.
Okay.
Ainsley is there because she somehow feels responsible as the initial discoverer of Zed.
Okay.
Frank cool. Chopped liver.
Well, Frank's not in the scene. Ainsley has a rivalry with Frank, so Frank does not count. All right, cool. Are we good?
Frankly, Frank's being tired of told that he doesn't count.
What were you going to say, Natalie?
Remind me, so we have Barbara and Ainsley in the room already.
Yep.
Who are you playing again, Bob, in the scene?
I am playing Sawyer.
Sawyer. And who are you playing, Ashley?
Zed.
Zed is already in the scene.
Yes.
Okay. Zed is in the bridge.
So Sawyer
is going
to enter.
Yeah. Yes. So, go ahead.
Okay, yeah, so I was just going to start with Barbara handing over a plate of cubes. And Zed just looks down at them and is like, what is this, jello?
It's meatloaf cubes.
I don't think meatloaf is supposed to wiggle like this.
Well, you see, the cube is nature's miracle. By compressing the food into cubes, we can actually pack more nutrients in it, and your body processes it over an extended period of time, so you can survive in space much longer.
I think as you were explaining that,
yeah.
Zed has started to, like, stuff their face with it. And, like, I think they speak with, like, a full mouth, and they're, like, so it's kind of muffled, and they're just, like, well, as long as it works, then I guess I don't really care.
Okay.
And, I don't think they've eaten very much in the past, however long they've been stowed away here.
Mm-hmm.
So, like I said, they're eating very fast. Don't choke like Sawyer, but, I think they are not paying very much attention to Ainsley or mm-hmm. Barbara.
Okay. Well, I'll turn to Ainsley and be like, Doctor, how is it even possible that someone has been able to survive eating non-processed food this long?
My understanding is people used to do it all the time. They called it organic. I don't know how long they can survive like this, but I'm glad that we found Zed when we did.
It's just unnatural.
Yeah.
On that cue, Sawyer charges into the room.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, no, we never established. These automatic opening and door close, do they open and close Star Trek style or Star Wars style? Because one is lethal, the other's not.
Which one is lethal?
Star Wars was, isn't it?
Yeah, let's do Star Wars one then. Is that
yes.
cool with everybody? Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so one of those blasts open and Sawyer comes running into the room. He's out of breath. He's apparently come from clear across the station.
Mm-hmm.
And as he's catching his breath, he's like doing one word each time. He's like, we have such a huge opportunity here. Hear me out. All right.
Okay. All right. Take your time.
Okay. All right. Zed, right?
No, I'm Barbara. That's Zed.
Zed. The one in the cage, right?
Zed. Yes.
Yeah. He, like, looks up from their food, like...
So this is someone here on the station who is newer than me.
Yes. Yes.
Who has not been eating the processed food for as long as I have.
Well, in fairness, they probably came on the same shuttle you did as the stowaway. I mean, that's the only way I can explain that they're not dead yet. But yeah, they haven't been eating the proper food.
So Zed, you've just been, what, scrounging from the harvest fields?
I think you've still got just like a mouthful of cube, and it's just like, yeah, I take a potato here and like a head of lettuce there, you know.
I think with that, you hear a knock on the door, and then another, and then another, and then another. There's four knocks.
Now that's just strange, because one, who knocks four times? I got just one.
I didn't even need to knock. I walked up and the door opened.
Well, obviously something is wrong.
Ainsley is going to walk over to the door.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't open.
She sort of puts her hands on it and like tries to sort of move the doors apart.
Nope.
Well, then it got locked for some reason. Check the little control panel.
Yeah, Ainsley goes over and removes the cover and starts looking at it, see if there's anything obvious. And as she's doing that, she says, hey, Dave, is there anything wrong with this?
Dave doesn't answer. And I think you start to hear a hiss. Just a
pssst. Well, that's
strange. Does anyone
strange.
Else hear that? From where?
It's coming from, I think, like, the next cell over, like, the bulkhead. And you realize the room is decompressing.
Guys,
it's,
do you want to check that out?
It's fine. It's just Ainsley's accent. Dave, stop decompressing room.
I think you hear like the speakers from that Dave normally comes out of, but it sounds like a music box of that nursery rhyme.
Guys, awesome. This is not funny. I think we should get out of here. Well, I think right. First you guys should let me out, and then we should all get out of here.
Charles, yeah. Okay, Charles, very funny. Ha ha. Tease the new guy. You know, prank the new guy. We get it. It's funny. All right, knock it off. Please.
Who are you talking to? What? There's no... Charles is not here. We're just...
He's... Look, if he's... doing, he's probably listening. He's listening. He's watching. You know him and Dave, how they get along? I mean, he could probably convince Dave to take part in a practical joke, right?
Ainsley is walking over to the bulkhead that sounds like it's decompressing and trying to get a closer look.
It has a hole in it. And you're rapidly losing oxygen in this room.
She looks for something with which to block it, and she says, there's a hole. Does anyone have some repair gel? Or where's Frank?
Well, I brought an apple cube just in case I got hungry. Can you put that in there?
I don't think an apple cube is going to do the trick, lady.
It's very dense nutritionally.
I mean, even I couldn't choke one of those down.
And Zed, at this point, Zed has ate all of their cubes in record time and is standing, like, at the... Well, let's see. Is this cell, like, bars? Or is it some fancy future cell that has, like, an invisible, like, wall or something?
I mean, I would think if we had force field walls, we'd have a high enough budget to get real food. We've defined that one out of existence here.
Good. Okay, so he's like standing at the bars and like has their hands like around him and is like rattling them. It's like, let me out before we all die.
Well, I'm sorry, but we either need Frank or Greta, or I think they're the only two people with keys to this door.
Well, pass me the food tray.
Okay.
And he'll like tilt it to the side so he can like slip it through the
great
bars
and
whatever.
And she's gonna try to sort of put the food tray over the hole to buy us at least a little time so we can work out the communications issue. So maybe we're not venting quite as quickly.
Yeah, I think that works. Like, things are venting slower now, but you've just bought yourself more time.
Sawyer is starting to panic now, and so he runs over to the comms panel, and, you know, just like an overly trained, hyperactive new guy, you can see he's, like, running down the by-the-book checklist in his head, like, how to get emergency comms going, and he's trying to reach Charles, he's trying to reach Yuri, he's trying to go through some, like, triple manual override to reach Dave, and after each time he strikes out, he starts to panic a little bit more each time, and you know, now he's kind of got a flop sweat going on, and he's on the verge of becoming the we're all gonna die guy.
I think the screen, which has just been a black screen, you're like at the screen, and for just a moment you see the words on it, good of you to use more oxygen, and like you turn around to go tell someone and the words are gone.
Ooh, all right, yeah, so upon that, Sawyer absolutely loses his shit. He runs over and grabs Frank. He's doing the whole grab him by the jacket cuff. He's like, we're all gonna die, give me the goddamn keys. He's trying to
Frank's not in this room.
So it's very, very clear how much oxygen deprivation Sawyer is experiencing already.
I think Zed is looking between the three others in here and is like, really? You can't get open the door? Like, I don't know, pry it open or something.
Oh, that's a good idea. What do we have to pry open the door with?
Frank's keys!
Frank's not here!
And we'll use his keys.
We'll do the dramatic double slap.
Get it together, man.
I'm sorry, they didn't cover this in cadet training.
And as they're kind of working that out. Zed is just like torn between trying to bend the bars to escape or look through his cell for like a secret hatch that he can only hope exists, but I don't think actually exists, but you can tell me if it exists or not.
You see like a panel, like maybe you could pull open.
Yeah. Zed doesn't know that it's probably a terrible idea, but he's going for it.
And you are pulled into the void of space along with the other three of you.
So the rest of us slammed across the bars, and I won't describe it for everybody, but then you can imagine us getting pulled through and out into space. Okay, cool.
Oh, God.
That was a good scene. That was a good scene.
Supposed to kill all four of you, right?
Yeah, you did. Yep. You did a great job.
Very
space
efficient.
Killed all
okay,
one.
Great.
The killer is space.
Yeah, the scene is over when all characters are dead in the scene. Let's like highlight over the characters we played so that we know we're dead. I'm just gonna use red. That's pretty deady. Yeah, red is dead color, right?
Red is dead. Red's dead, baby. Red's dead.
Cool.
I don't know what it means that I originated two of the dead characters.
You know?
Only good things, I'm sure.
So now we're going to do a standard scene, and we're going to have standard scenes for a while. In a standard scene, the killer establishes the scene. The players choose their characters. It's free role play. And when the killer goes to strike, that's when we're going to use the cards again. Once one character is dead, we wrap up the scene. And it very specifically says here, the killer establishes the scene before each player chooses a character to play in it. So, Rosie, that's you this time. You're the killer. And where do you think the next scene should take place? Give us a little something.
Okay, so we've looked at two of the biomes thus far. We've looked at the lunchroom.
Mm-hmm. The sort of office spacey type area. Yep.
And the fields.
Mm-hmm.
So let's start with a biome at the opposite end, and let's go with the sleeping quarters.
Oh, yes, the sleeping biome. I love the sleeping biome. Excellent. All right, so the rest of us are gonna pick characters, and only one person will die this round, just so you know. Who has got a character they would love to play?
I would like to play Charles. That's okay.
That's great. Have you played Charles yet?
I have not.
Awesome. So that's.
I would love.
Yep, go ahead.
I'd love to take Frank out for a spin.
Awesome.
I'd like to.
Go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
I'm going to grab Dave.
No, you hang up.
And this is scene 5. All right, who do you want then, Natalie?
Does it need to be a character we haven't played?
It doesn't, but it's... Okay. I think it's preferred, okay. But I don't think it has to be.
Okay. It just makes sense for the captain to be...
Oh, let's do it then. Yeah. Grab the captain.
I'll play Xena.
All right, so it's Dave the AI, Xena the captain, I'm clicking on something that I've already clicked on. Who else do we have?
Frank the janitor.
Frank the janitor. And one more. That's only three people, right?
Charles?
Who's Charles?
Me.
Great, Charles. All right, Charles the first officer, Xena the captain, Frank the janitor, and Dave the AI in the sleeping quarters. Killer, do you want to give us a little more start to our scenes now that you know that these amazing characters are there? What's going on in the sleeping quarters? Are we literally going to start the scene by sleeping? Or?
Okay, I want to make sure I know who's in the scene. It was Frank, Dave, and who were the other two?
Charles and Xena. Charles is the first officer. Xena is the captain.
Cool. No, I don't think you're all waking up.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's maybe more midday, so unless you like cat naps.
Mm-hmm.
Janitor definitely likes taking naps.
Okay.
And it's definitely a space that's meant to be relaxing, so it's these really almost sickening pastel colors.
Okay. I could see maybe the captain and the first officer breaking to do something together. What do y'all have any idea, like, what you might do to relax as, at the leadership level?
Ping pong.
Ping pong?
I would say drink. Yeah. I don't know if I can drink in the middle of the day, but...
So, I'm sorry, did we just establish beer pong as the future?
Ping no, ping pong.
Well, it's ping pong and drinking, so I wanted to be sure.
No, no, no.
Except
I think...
the alcohol is cute.
It's cute alcohol?
Yes! Weird futuristic jello shots because we can't afford a holodeck.
I mean, if the mission has gone on this long and has so few people, maybe the officers are bored.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Is there much for Zeta to do?
Yeah.
Like, when we last saw Zeta, she was, like, a risk-taker, like, all about fun, and, like all about action and all that, and now she's just like, you know what, I'm never gonna get off this station, I'm gonna retire here, I'm just killing time.
So, we're gonna play the scene freeform until the killer, Rosie, decides to interrupt us to try to kill somebody. And you, Rosie, you can do that whenever you want, however you think it makes sense, okay? And I will say, Xena is the captain. Give us the first line, Xena.
I think, like, she's setting up a server. Can you believe a fucking stowaway?
I think Charles looks very unenthusiastic about the idea of playing ping pong right now, but they give their best.
I think Xena is in, like, a Hawaiian shirt at this point, and, like, you know, like, sweatpants.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and Charles is wearing probably just, like, a nondescript, like, gray t-shirt, gray sweatpants, just grout fit, and, like, hits the ball back and is like, yep, stowaway, most exciting thing that's happened in the... however long we've been here.
Jamie's off to the side, kind of sitting down on the floor with his back up against his bunk. He's got a racquetball and he's bouncing it off the floor against the wall and catching it over and over again. When he hears you guys say the stowaway, he's like, oh yeah, stowaway. More mess to clean up. It's fantastic. Super exciting. I'm glad you're all happy.
I'm just so happy about all of this, Frank. Don't worry.
I am not looking forward to having to write up the report. Do we have to write up a report? We could just not tell anyone, right?
Nice. Go ahead, Rosie.
There's a moment where the different balls that you guys are playing with are all in the air, none are actually bouncing, and you hear a knock.
Oh, just in that one moment of clear sound.
Just one moment of clarity, there is a single knock.
Okay, so I miss my ball. Do not catch it after being distracted by that.
Point. Captain.
Thank you, Dave.
Charles just kind of, like, looks over. Did the knock seem to come from the door or, like, from anywhere in particular, or was it hard to tell?
Can't really tell.
I think Charles will kind of, like, straighten up, look towards the door, look back to the captain and say, it's not locked, is it?
Old stations get the knocks, and she, like, walks over and, like, wave hand at the door.
It does not open.
Oh.
But you do hear another knock farther in the quarters.
Dave, what's up with the door?
The door is not particularly up, Captain.
Can you open it?
Accessing door. Can I open it?
Oh, no.
I cannot access door at this time.
What do you mean you can't access door?
When I access door, door does not respond.
Can you get Yuri on the phone?
Calling Yuri.
And in that ringtone, you start to hear the nursery rhyme. I think Charles, you know you were humming this morning.
Yeah, as this is happening, like as that whole conversation is happening, I think Charles would have went over to the like the door panel and started playing around with it, assumingly unsuccessfully. And as that ringtone with the weird nursery rhyme starts, he kind of stops and like looks towards the nearest Dave terminal and is like just giving it a very confused look and is like, does that sound familiar to anyone?
What sound familiar? The ringtone? Hey Dave?
Captain.
Maybe the stowaway got out and is causing issues. Can you check on the status of the stowaway for me?
Accessing stowaway. Stowaway is in fact out.
Wait, what?
Stowaway is in fact out.
Can you locate him?
Stowaway is located.
And tell us where he is?
Stowaway is outside the station.
Wait, did he get an exosuit? And I think with that, Xena like goes like, I think there's like a viewport, and like goes and like looks outside.
Mm-hmm.
And at this point, you are going to. Someone was playing with the panel by the door.
Yeah, Charles was.
Charles is going to receive an electric shock from the panel. Not enough to hurt you, really. It's just uncomfortable and painful, and you withdraw your hands. And by the window the captain is looking out of, you... I'm imagining the base is, like, on the surface of something. It's not just floating
sure.
in space.
What are we on the surface of?
Let's go with some kind of moon.
Yeah.
Something almost a little okay. pointless.
Cool.
Like a third moon.
Yeah.
Not even a first or second moon.
Yeah.
And there's something on the surface that you don't think should be there. You've been on this moon for a while. You really feel... You know this place about as well as anyone can. Mm-hmm. And... It's right up close against the glass. It looks almost like a conglomeration of different bits of space trash. If there was like a weird space tumbleweed.
Huh.
Ow.
Dave, can you enhance on that unknown object?
You want me to enhance the view outside of the window, Captain?
Yeah, can't you do that? Like, put it on a view screen or something?
No. This is not CSI Mars, Captain.
You know, that's one of my favorite shows.
Hey, Frank, can you come over here and, like, get this panel working or whatever? Charles is like, shaking his hand after getting shocked.
Well, yeah, I suppose I could. I don't really think that's my job.
Well, we're stuck in here otherwise.
You know what? That
failing to see how that's a problem. I mean, I was looking forward to a nap anyways.
That botanist who transferred off like a month and a half ago had bird watching stuff. Hold on, I think there's binoculars.
And you don't need it because suddenly it's right up against the glass and it's just kind of very sudden and percussive, like a much louder knock.
What is that?
What is it?
What does it look like now that it's closer?
Jennifer stands up and looks out the window too.
I described it as a tumbleweed. It still is definitely
very much a mess of wires, but the wires are starting to almost look a little bit like fingers. You're making out details of a face. You're starting to maybe see almost scales, the way that everything is fitting together. It's sort of starting to draw itself down over the glass a bit and feel around the window.
Okay. So
all right, now you want to get out, Frank?
Yeah, janitor's grabbing his little tool belt and he's going over to the door and poking and prodding and screaming over the intercom at Yuri, like, where the hell are you?
And there's another one. And another one.
Dave, can you get Yuri? Can you get Greta? Can you get literally anyone on the phone?
Yuri is not picking up his comms. Dialing Greta.
And they start tapping the ends of their nails in time with that nursery rhyme against the window.
Dave, stop. Stop that sound.
Ending call.
No. Keep calling.
Calling Greta.
And eventually, you can't see the outside anymore. It's just all of these things, these odd space junk life forms with their nails tapping against the window. And then you hear that tapping in the room with you, right behind you. Right behind you, Xena.
I think Xena reaches for her sidearm and realizes she doesn't have it on. And, like, whips around, like, ready to fight.
And right behind you is... it's taller than you by maybe a foot. You're not sure how the hell it was in the room with you and you didn't see it. But this is almost like a bunch of little bits and bobs of in the room were suddenly pulled together to make this thing that shouldn't be here. Like, you recognize your toothbrush in there somewhere, someone's screwdriver. It doesn't really matter, because suddenly it is moving its hand towards your throat. Okay. And
I think Xena dies.
Okay, so let's find out. There's mechanics for this. There's mechanics for this. So we're all going to draw cards. Not the killer, but the rest of us. So this is what you're going to do. You are going to grab one card and pull it to your digital playing area so that you can see it. Now, you are going to look at your character area. And you're going to draw one extra card for every relationship your current character has established.
Even if they're dead?
Even if they're dead.
People that are dead?
That's right. Okay.
Wow.
Oh, someone's got a lot of relationships, huh? All right, cool. So this is how it's going to work. The killer uses the remaining deck. Killer, you have chosen your target. Who is your target?
My target is Xena.
Xena, excellent. Da, 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 da. So, what you're going to do, the killer is going to pull a card off and just flip it over next to the deck. And you, yeah. Oh, no! Oh.
Deal with that!
That is an ace of hearts! Oh. Okay, great.
Yikes.
So, let's see here what options you have, okay? Because this is the first time we've played a regular scene, and there are choices here. Oh my gosh. The target is going to try to play a card that is higher than the card that was played. Let's see. Do I have a quick reference for suits and...
which... I don't have anything higher.
Oh, you don't have an ace? Okay, that's cool. That's cool. That's cool.
So it's fine.
Cool. It looks like the suits go diamonds, hearts, spades, clubs, just for future reference.
I don't have the ace of diamonds.
Okay, cool. Yeah, this is hard. So it looks like you're going to die, except I think there is a thing here. Establishing relationships, first blood, standard schemes. Relationships in the face of the killer. Okay, so relationships are very important as part of the resolution. So the killer is attempting to kill the target. That's great. The high card comes out, and that's the threat, which is very high. Does anybody in the scene have a relationship with the person who's dying? I don't have a relationship with Xena.
I do not.
Nope.
Okay. Nope. Yeah, you're dead. You're dead.
Yeah.
So go ahead and describe the character's death for us, killer, and then we will start a new scene.
All right. You see this hand just come right at your throat, and you have the absurd thought, that's my razor, as that punctures your throat. And there's this magnificent spray of blood, like Quentin Tarantino style, across the window with all of those tapping nails.
Yikes.
Great. So that's the end of the scene. Now we're going to do one more thing. Everybody who's... So if you just died, please highlight your thing red in our notes so we know. And if you survived the scene, you're going to add to your little card that you have one survivor point. Now anyone playing a survivor at any time can spend a survivor point to get rid of one of the cards they pulled and pull a new one.
At any time?
At any time. So maybe when you're about to die is a good time to try it. All right, cool. This is a great time to take our final break. We're going to take a really quick break so our players get a chance to refill up their cups and drain anything that needs draining. I love everybody here. We will be right back. And we are back. We're coming up into the final 45 minutes of our stream, so we're gonna have lots of fun killing the last 4 to 5 people. We'll see exactly how this ends. I think that there isn't necessarily a survivor, if I remember correctly. I'll get to that scene when I come to it. But for now, I'm going to set the scene, and I want to set the scene in the final biome. We've had our working biome, we've had our living biome, we've had our harvest biome, and the fourth biome, of course, is a combat biome. It emulates the moon's surface, which is hilarious to me, as the moon is right outside. But there's breathable air. And the craters come in different sizes so that we can, shoot guns, drive vehicles, and practice combat technology as it gets developed. And, so who would like to be in this scene? Which characters? Everyone's going to pick a character. It doesn't matter how many things they have. There's 5 characters left. 4 of them are going to get picked.
I'll pick up Greta.
Great.
I would like to play Dave.
Awesome. That leaves Charles, Yuri, and Frank.
I'll take Yuri.
Okay.
Then I'll be Charles again.
Okay, great. So what I would love is to start with Yuri and Greta, as they weren't in the last scene. They can give us a little freeform role play and show us what the combat module is like. And then we can have our two survivors from the other scene show up. Does that sound great?
Huh?
They've always there, but yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Sorry.
That's okay.
But we can have a survivor from the other scene show up. All right. Great. So let's... Who wants to start of those two?
So you promised the flamethrower was going to work this time, right, Yuri?
Of course it's going to work. Yuri would never tell you lies.
That's what you told me last time, and it was basically a jetpack.
It throw flames, okay?
Yeah, but what I want them out of the nozzle.
It's not Yuri's fault you hold it upside down.
All right. And I think like there's like a scarecrow type mannequin like out on the moon surface, and Greta picks up like this big flamethrower and like pulls the trigger on it.
I'd say it works. Yuri's not messing with her in this one.
Okay.
It definitely works. But then Yuri takes, you know, those the buffer sticks, uh-huh, or whatever.
Yeah.
And just like clubs her upside the head with one. It's lesson number two in combat. Pay attention.
What do you know about combat? You build the guns, I shoot them. I'm the one who knows how to shoot them.
You know, pay attention.
You gotta pay attention to what's out here. You just gotta pay attention to what's in front of you and make sure you hit it.
Okay, big, tough security person. I surrender.
Ugh.
And then, hang on. So Yuri reaches down into his pocket and pulls out a little remote control.
It's too bad Yuri has this. Do you know what this is, Greta?
What is it?
This emergency off switch for artificial gravity. Beep.
Dave laughs in robot.
Dave, can you restore gravity, please?
One moment. Restoring gravity to this section of the space station. And there's like a few moments, and then gravity returns to normal.
Yeah, and I think, you know, at this point, Greta's already floating a few feet off the ground and just collides with the moon dust.
Yeah, that's good. Yuri's just laughing his ass off.
Oh, Greta, you fall for things. Get it? You fall for things. Ah.
Oh, yeah,
is a gravity joke.
we should be using...
right, Dave. See, even Dave thinks it's funny.
I don't know why we're not using the stowaway for target practice.
That's mean.
He snuck aboard our ship. He's been eating our food. We could have starved.
Well, it's lucky.
How soon is it going to be till we have to cut cube rations?
Oh, break my heart.
Look, I like cubes, okay?
You're a very scary person, Greta.
Good. That's the point.
Charles, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, at this point, I think Charles stumbles in. He's still holding that ping pong racket, and he's just, I don't, Xena's dead.
Wait, what?
There are these things, they're here, they're outside. She's dead.
What do you mean, things?
I don't know. I have
Is there like a I'm imagining the nearest like Dave screen.
Yeah.
Lights up. And it's just like a snapshot of footage like of the thing, and it doesn't show Xena dying, but it's probably from like just before, and it shows like the...
Why are you just telling us this, Dave?
I am just learning this right now.
Dave, let us run diagnostic number 63 alpha. Why are you on time delay?
Running diagnostics 63 alpha. Time to completion, 5 minutes.
What?
I think the audio system starts playing that familiar nursery song as if it was the hold music for the system.
Why does everyone love this song? Yeah, Dave plays this song. Charles, you sing this song. Why are you holding ping pong paddle?
Oh, just frel this, and he like runs over to the weapons rack and grabs something that looks big.
Yeah, we can shoot these things. Whatever they are, aliens, whatever. We just kill them. That's what I'm here to do. And I think she like cocks a flamethrower for some reason.
Is no such thing as alien.
There is a knock at the door.
I think
just like, come in, you live here.
Yes. Dave is still singing the song.
Hello, open door, come in.
There is another knock, and then another, and they've begun hitting the door in a furious motion, one after the other after the other.
Who's...
It's not opening, right?
It is not opening.
Good.
There's a lot of them.
We have someone on the ship who no longer knows how to use door. This is not good.
No, you don't get it. That's not one of us. That's well, whatever killed Xena.
Us are all in this room. Anyone not in this room by definition is not one of us.
I agree with Yuri. Okay, great.
Thank you. Thank you, Dave. This is first time you ever agree with me. I like this.
Can you give us a report on the rest of the crew, Dave?
One moment. And there's like a brief moment, and then I think on the Dave screen shows, and it shows a map of the whole like space station, and you see the section that has the cells, like that whole just like section is just bright red. And he says, there has been a breach in the hull of biome, whatever it's called.
Let's call it the office quarters. Let's put it in there.
Sure.
Yeah.
There has been a breach in the hull of the office quarters. The entire section has been compromised.
Why are you just telling me this now, Dave? You're supposed to tell me these things right away.
I am just learning this now.
And the pounding, it just gets faster and faster on the door.
Fine,
I'm coming. You just open the door and fight these things.
I have to go fix front anyways. So Yuri goes up and tries to hit the button to open the door.
Great, you hit the button to open the door, and it does in fact open. And in swarms, just at least 10 of these amalgamated humanoids. And it seems like three of them go to just like dogpile you at once, Yuri, as you are the one who opened the door. And let us pull cards. You're going to pull cards the exact same way. You're going to pull one card, and then you're going to pull one additional card for every relationship you are in. Everyone is going to do that. Pulling cards. Pulling cards.
So we all pull cards?
Yeah. Everyone in the scene, except for me. Because you might be able to assist, depending on what happens.
Gotcha.
All right, are we good? We all have cards? All right, so here is my attack on Yuri. Oh, it's a 2. Yuri, do you have something that will beat my 2 of spades? Great. So Yuri, what? Describe how you get away from the 3 who go to climb on top of you.
Okay, so Yuri has extremely fast reflexes.
Mm-hmm.
Inappropriately fast for an engineer. Maybe he played some high-risk sport back on Earth. I don't know. Whatever. Future ball. He played future ball in college, which is a lot like sports ball of our present.
Mm-hmm.
And so he ducks down and just dives forward through the door into the next room. Comes Great. Up, smacks the button to close the door.
Dave Shrugs.
Amazing. One of the things in the rules that we hadn't gotten to yet is now that Yuri has survived, I cannot target Yuri again this scene. But that leaves several people in the scene. So Charles and... I'm sorry, Greta. The horde starts moving towards you as one stays behind to pound on the door. What do you do?
I pull the trigger on my flamethrower.
Oh, amazing. And you just start blasting these things with fire. And I think through the flame comes like 3 random objects. It is like the base of an electric toothbrush, a spoon, and a bit of pipe. And they're all like super heated. You can see them glowing as they come towards you. I'm going to attempt to kill you.
Okay.
I'm going to just clear these 2 cards real quick, and I will grab a new one. I got a 7. Can you beat that? Oh, okay. All right. So you survive this scene. How do you avoid the superheated metal?
I think with her other hand, she pulls out a pistol and shoots them out of the air.
Great.
Oh, that's so kick-ass.
That is kind of amazing.
Yeah.
What about you, Charles? What are you doing?
He is just unloading his future space shotgun thing.
Mm-hmm.
Not at the 3 that Greta is focused on, but the other ones that had skittered into the room.
Great. So as you focus on these ones that are slowly coming towards you, you start blasting them away with shotgun shells. And you see like little holes form in them, and they don't seem to slow down, nor do the holes fill. They're just sort of like walking around a little bit more Swiss cheese. But as you shoot one that is really close to the door, you see a bunch of shrapnel just sort of go into that Dave monitor we see, and electricity starts to crackle. So, Dave, I am now targeting you.
Oh no, Dave! We thought you were safe.
That is a 6.
I got it.
Oh, so boring. All right.
Well, hang on.
Yep. I'm sorry. Yes. Let's.
I was flipping through and I see that as a rival.
Yes, thank you. I'm sorry. I forgot about that.
I can switch out the killer's card.
Yes.
Which is something that I have.
You can.
Dave.
So here's the interesting thing. Yuri is rivals with both Dave and Greta.
I already cleared Greta of safety, but you can do Dave.
Okay. In that case, sorry, Dave. You gotta go.
Ooh.
Ooh. Okay.
Yep. Go ahead.
So I can play another card?
I think if you have a card that can still beat it, you can, yes.
Can I use a survivor point?
You may use a survivor point to get rid of a card and pull a new one.
Okay, I'm going to do that.
Okay.
So I'm going to get rid of this card.
Great. I don't know where to put just it. Just stick it on the somewhere that we're not using things.
There.
Great.
Yep. Here. Don't need that 4 anymore. No, that's not helpful. All I got is a jack.
Oh, okay.
I can't beat a jack.
A jack of clubs does not beat a jack of spades. We hear... actually, you tell us. Why don't you say... What does it look like as Dave comes out of existence?
Yeah, so I think... you hear Dave's voice right before the shrapnel like hits, and it's like, diagnostic 63 alpha complete. We have found, and then there's like the shrapnel hits, and it's like,
oh,
and the screen like goes dark. And I think, actually, a lot of the electronic things that were reliant on like Dave to run them also go dark. So like,
fantastic.
Like, door control panel, I don't know, some other things, whatever you guys think is cool.
All right, super. So we're going to jump to the next scene. We're going to start to play a little bit quicker. We've got four people left. Aid, it is your turn to play the killer. Congratulations. Will you set our next scene for us, please?
So...
all four people are going to be in this scene.
Yes. I think the scene will take place... do you think the office section would have the, like, control, like, area?
That's like, up to you. You're setting the scene.
Okay, yeah. So I think it takes place not in that room, but in the hallway, or the corridor is kind of heading to that room as the remaining people are trying to secure the base by going to like the main control room.
Okay, cool. Great. So we've got Greta, Frank, Yuri, and Charles. Does anybody really want to play somebody?
I'll take Charles. I haven't gotten Charles yet.
Okay, cool. I'll grab Yuri. I haven't played Yuri.
I'll take Greta. I haven't done Greta yet.
Great.
That leaves me with Frank.
Oh, right. Fantastic. And Frank, you weren't with the last group, so I think it makes sense that you can join the scene whenever you want, just to keep things flowing.
Sounds good.
All right. So Yuri is in the hallway, and he is at the door they need to get into to get to the command center, and he's got the panel open, and he's just frantically engineering with a flashlight in his mouth, just trying to do things. And be like, shoddy workmanship, I tell you, I should have been on the crew that sent it up and started here. All this just complaining the whole time.
Yeah, Greta's got her flamethrower and she is guarding the man that's trying to solve our problem.
It's this door open. We have to get to the control room.
Oh, that's what I am doing, new captain. Thank you.
All right, about that time, janitor comes strolling up and says, Yuri, I think you need one of these. It's a key. Inserts the key, unlocks the locking, manual locking mechanism.
Those space keys.
So I think as Love you it. Go to, like, as you stick the key in to the manual lock, you hear from the other side a single knock.
Should we still?
There's no viewport.
No viewport in the space door.
Well, I unlocked the door. Charles, you can do the honors.
I think I pull the door open, expecting Greta to like cover fire.
Okay.
She does.
There is nothing on the other side.
So Greta, just do you shoot the flamethrower anyway, just out of instinct, or?
She's not quite that on edge yet,
okay.
But she stays very close and is definitely the first one through the door.
And as you guys, like, enter this control room, you see, normally I think at least Charles would be used to this, like, main control room, and, you're used to seeing it all lit with all of these different computer screens and, like, different monitors and different, you know, all different sorts of indicators, but everything is, like, dark.
Dave, turn on power.
Oh, it's okay. We just have to reboot to DOS real quick. Hold on. Control-Alt-F7-Z. Control Alt F7Z.
As Yuri is doing that, you start hearing this knocking coming from. I'm imagining this is like a big console, like a big rack that you're like working on. So you hear it coming from like within that. And it gets louder and louder.
I think Charles backs away.
Yuri stays there. It's just. Because, of course, it's not like an automatic reboot. You got to start typing in binary now.
Yeah, and like as you're typing, all of a sudden the whole thing kind of just like explodes in like this spectacular like explosion of shrapnel, and one of the monsters like emerges from it and like jumps onto Yuri.
Fantastic. All right.
I'm going to try to kill him.
Yes. All right, everybody grab new cards. I just recalled the deck.
Okay.
The one, two.
I'm gonna spin the spinner.
One, two. Wait, one, two, three, four. Okay, sorry. Counting hard. So, and this is a good time to point out to everyone, because I don't think I said it earlier, that the killer can target as many people as they want at once, but. As soon as they survive the scene, they survive the scene. And they can't get targeted again that scene. Alright, I have as many cards as I need.
Cool. Here is my card. It is a king.
Okay, cool. So, I'm going to go ahead and drop this 4 next to your king. And I'm going to just check here. I am playing Yuri. I have a rival with Greta, but all of my friends are dead. And I don't have a survivor point. Press F for Yuri.
Okay, so
Yuri's just charred ball. And there's just one of the monsters on top of him killing him anymore.
All right. What do the rest of you guys do?
I think that cuts to the next scene.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Scene is over. Well, yep. That was a fun scene, guys.
Yeah, great. Let's jump to the next one. Let's keep going. I love it. So after Ashley, Aid, it is Bob. Bob, you are the killer. You get to set the scene. And we're down to 3 players. So somebody will sit this out as we have Greta, Charles, and Frank left.
Okay, so assuming at this point, this is the part in the movie where, you know, people start trying to scramble and getting home or whatever, so it makes sense for the next scene to be in the engine room.
Oh, great.
Which is even better because Yuri's dead.
Okay.
So it's in the engine room. Who are our 3 characters?
We've got Charles, the burnt-out first officer, Frank, the janitor, and Greta, the trigger-happy weapons officer.
Okay, so I guess, yes, they've gone to the engine room, and I guess the idea is to try and get the engines going, and, I mean, they probably get, like, what, a 57 light-year journey back to Earth,
We'll just launch the whole station off of the moon and back to Earth.
Wishful thinking at this point.
Yes. Does anybody really want to grab one of these characters?
I'll take Frank.
All right.
I haven't been Frank yet.
I don't mind sitting out this one.
Okay, I'll grab Charles then, if you want to keep playing Greta, or I know you just played Greta, so I can grab Greta back.
Oh, I'm happy being Greta.
Okay, great, so I'll grab Charles. Charles is pacing in the engine room, and he's just like, this is just like Pegasus 4. It's Pegasus 4 all over again. That means we can make it. That means we can get through this. We just gotta shoot the space station off, and then once we're off into space, we just manually detach each of the pods. It'll be fine.
I don't think we can pull that off more than once.
Frank is lighting a cigarette.
Okay, then we're all just gonna die! Is that what you want to hear?
No. We just have to shoot our way out. That's it. Just shoot them all.
Shoot our way to where?
By one. I don't know. They're all going to die at some point. There can't be an infinite number. And she, once again, cocks a flamethrower for some reason.
You hear knocking. This time, it's almost just like you're listening to the sound of a recording of someone knocking on metal, and it's coming out of the speakers that Dave would usually speak through.
I don't like that. I'm just going to start counting shotgun shells. 1, 2, 3. Yeah.
Frank doesn't have a gun yet.
Here, Frank, take my shotgun. I know a little engineering from school. Start.
I think
cranking
Frank
things.
Has a cigarette in his mouth.
Yeah.
All right. So the engine begins to start spinning and turn over, and you know, as these things start to spin, whatever, they give out like a high pitched whining sound. But the RPMs of the segment of the engine are rapidly changing, so that tone given off is matching the nursery rhyme, and so it's this really like twisted, modulated. That effect of like portamento where it goes, it's like going in between the pitches, not snapping them, and it's really disconcerting. And it sounds like the main bearings of the primary engine shaft are starting to knock loose, and they are producing that knocking sound at every revolution.
Isn't there that shuttle that they use to explore the rest of the moon?
Oh, we're past that.
Cleaned it.
Oh, no. I just got to crank this crank. This is our shuttle now, Frank. This is our shuttle now, Frank.
All right, so as he's cranking the crank there, it happens so fast he doesn't even realize that the crank has become like somewhat animated. It's broken apart at its different joints, and it's wrapping around his arm like an anaconda would. And linkage is coming out of the engines, and it's wrapping all around him, trying to choke him. And so, the it, whatever it is trying to kill.
All right, let's grab some cards.
Frank has a lot of relationships.
Yeah, Frank's got some math on his side.
Sure. The janitor knows everybody.
That's true. Really saved her ass with those keys.
Saved someone's ass. Not yours.
Okay, I'm got my cards.
So now I flip one?
Yep. Ooh, I am going to beat that with my 8 of diamonds. And all of my relationships are dead.
Well, no, I thought, aren't you Frank? Diamonds... I'm your rival.
Oh, that's not under Charles's thing. I'll add it.
Wait. I thought you were Frank. I apologize.
No, I'm Charles.
I'm Frank.
Ignore what I said.
So I managed to pull the snake off and say, I'm tired of these goddamn animated snakes on this shuttle. And I'm just going to like bite it in half and rip it apart. Go.
So can I keep going?
Yes. You have two more targets.
So as the crank came off of that main engine shaft, the shaft and the bearings are starting to break loose, and gears and bits of metal are flying around. They explode out, hitting various portions of the hull, but then they sort of start coming back together and coalescing around each other into this blob of razor sharp gears and torn metal.
And takes off running.
You don't run from a gear like that. Frank doesn't know the first rules of horror movies. You can't turn around.
Yeah, Greta does not turn her back. She stands her ground, takes a stance, and opens up with that flamethrower.
All right, well, it goes straight at Frank.
Okay.
And I'm trying to think of the name of that horror movie series with the little balls that floated through the air. I can't think of it.
All right, so, let's switch your card. Oh, you got a 9 of spades. Oh, but whoa. Frank's got a queen. But did we establish that somebody has a rivalry relationship with Frank?
Greta. Can you beat a queen?
Hold on, I need to unmute myself, and then I need to check my cards.
Yes.
I cannot beat... Wait, do I have to draw over a queen, or do I substitute a lower card?
You would want the higher card because the queen is the hero, and you would be replaced.
I cannot beat your queen, which is unfortunate.
You wanted Frank to die? That's fantastic.
Well, it's better than Greta.
Well, Greta is going to be the last one targeted, I think, somehow. So, but Frank gets into another part of the spaceship, which is really interesting for the next scene.
Right.
All right. What happens next, killer?
So, all of that stuff just sort of arbitrary, like really quickly and like it never happened, just drops to the ground, the gravity affecting it. But now you're starting to realize that when those things hit the hull, they punctured holes in it.
Oh, no.
And you can hear the air leaking out and feel the air starting to leak out. And so, as the room begins to decompress, another 9.
Oh, what do you got?
So do we all display cards?
No, I'm sorry. It's only the last person, Greta. Greta's being targeted.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't realize I was literally the last person.
Yes. There's only 3 of us now.
I have a 10.
Okay.
Oh, I have failed.
Well, hold on. Hold on, because...
Frank
has a rivalry with Greta, and
I don't have a higher than a 10.
Oh, okay. So everyone is going to survive this time, and so I think Charles, with just all the grit of a action hero, starts grabbing the little snake pieces that didn't go flying off, and starts just forcing them into the holes, like just manually jamming them into this exceptionally complicated space plastic. So, they're like, we're gonna live, damn it! And we'll cut to the next scene, which Natalie gets to describe and play the killer.
I'll start for this one.
Okay.
I think the next scene... it happens like almost immediately, like as Frank like turns a corner and is running for that shuttle, comes face to face with like the biggest one of these things he's ever seen, and there's like knocking as it's moving, and it's got Sawyer's face.
Oh no!
Oh, no, for Sawyer.
Ashley, Aide, since you set the last one out, do you want to be Frank?
Yeah, I'll
start.
Be Frank.
Cool. So you get to start in the scene.
Yeah.
Greta, should we just stay as our characters?
I'm fine with that.
All right, so we'll be Greta and Charles may come in to help you in a moment. We'll see.
Okay.
And I think this thing is like filling the whole hallway and just moving toward you.
Yeah. So I imagine Frank like turning a corner and just like seeing this like massive body that has this like amalgamation, but also just has like Sawyer's face. Which is terrifying, and I think he does that thing where he kind of is frozen for a split second before he starts like slowly backing away, and like he after a few moments he like turns and like starts to run back the way he came, and as he's running he's like screaming, he's like shit guys.
Cool. I'm sorry. Great. So you're running backwards, and I think you bump right into Charles, who has no weapon because he gave you the shotgun. And he's just like, Frank, what is it? Snap out of it!
You hear the knocking coming from down the hall as this thing is slowly coming closer.
Don't go that way. It's one of those things. It's the whole hallway's blocked.
But that's the shuttle, Frank. We have to go that way. I don't even know where...
We can't go that way.
Yeah, Greta steps, like, towards where the thing is coming from and is like, well, we gotta go back the other way. There has to be another way off this freaking thing.
There's another way to the shuttle. And Frank will start leading them down, like, a side hallway.
Okay. I think you're running down the side hallway and, like, something just reaches out of a corner... And you're leading Frank.
Yeah.
And just tries to, like, slice you.
Ah.
All right, grab some cards.
All right, hold on. I have no idea what scene number this is.
But... Don't worry about that anymore. We're good.
Okay.
It will all be over soon.
Yes.
All right. I've
Everyone got cards. Cards?
Yes.
All right.
All be right, mine, Frank.
I will.
Greta, can you screw?
I can. Queen!
Oh, no! Frank, can you...
Frank tried his... Yeah. I guess I could draw a card with my survivor point, right?
Has it been spent yet?
I don't think it has.
All right, great.
I'll get rid of this two. And get... what's the order? No. The red ones are first. All I got was this black queen.
Oh, no!
But Frank... okay, so can I describe his death?
I want to describe the monster as you see it.
Yeah.
Same one that killed Xena, and this one now has Xena's face.
Oh, great.
But it's got her razor still.
Yeah, so I think as, like, it bursts out, like, the arm, the movement grabs Frank's attention. So, like, at the last minute, and perhaps, unfortunately, he, like, turns to, like, look at the movement, and he sees... Xena's face just as the razor arm like reaches out and just like destroys his throat. It like stabs him right in the throat, and again there's another spectacular spray of blood, and he like drops his shotgun and he's dead. He's super dead.
Love it. Alright, so Rosie, you are the next killer. Where do we pick up the next scene?
Okay, so let's put everyone back where we started, in the cafeteria.
Great. Charles and Greta are getting to the cafeteria. I love it. Bob, you sat out last time. Would you like to grab Charles or Greta?
I'll take Charles.
Great. And since I was in the last... Well, I guess we were all in the last scene, weren't we?
You pick up Greta.
Okay, I'll grab Greta. It'll be Charles and Greta in the cafeteria. And maybe we're just back to back now because, that's it. We're just down to the two of us waiting for something to happen. It's just eerily quiet. Is that cool?
Yeah.
So
Charles kind of, runs to the sort of the middle of the room, takes a look around, and it's dawning on him that it's the cafeteria. And this look of fatalistic dread comes over his face. He says, "How did I know it was always going to come to this fucking place? I'm going to die here."
"What's the matter, Charles? You don't like cubes?"
"No, I don't like cubes. You all know that I don't like cubes. I hate the cubes. I hate everything about this place. You know, this was supposed to be my last rotation. I was going to go home. I was going to retire after this. And now, Captain's dead. Yuri's dead. Even Dave's gone. I'd say I'm going to miss that guy, but I don't think I'm going to be around much longer. What are we going to do? You're supposed to be the weapons person. You're supposed to protect us."
"Well, there was one thing that I was saving, just in case things got dark." And Greta reaches into her vest, and she pulls out Future Space Grenade.
At which point, the cube dispenser, cube presser, something.
Yes.
It lurches up. And sort of pulls together all of the things that the utensils and the trays and everything, and builds like this larger body and heaves itself over the counter and starts launching the cubes right at Charles.
Yeah, it's going to Charles.
Charles, I'm coming for you.
Charles, the cubes. Oh, all right. Charles and Greta, let's grab some cards. Let's grab one less card. So let's just grab enough cards for our relationships. Let's give the killer a slightly better chance.
Okay. Has everyone finished grabbing their
I have my cards.
All right, hang on. Oh, there it is. I was going to say, I seem to have lost my... All right, so I get cards for...
each relationship.
Even the ones that are dead?
Even the ones that are dead.
Okay, but we're doing one less.
Yeah, we're just not going to get our extra card.
Okay, so I'm good.
All right. Killer. Killer gets a seven of clubs. What do you got? Oh, no. So the cubes don't kill you somehow. The food cubes that we described as jello, like, somehow don't have enough concussive force to bring you down, Charles.
I had to try it. It felt so
it's
right.
Cool.
It did. It's poetic.
And I think that gives me the chance, Greta, to rush forward and be like, you should always have a balanced breakfast, and just shove my arm with the grenade, like, into whatever orifice I can find. Which sounds pretty dangerous to me. I don't know. What do you think, Killer Rosie?
Well, I mean, you know that there's a bunch of these utensils, and unfortunately, I don't think I have, like, laser knives to play mm-hmm. with, but I definitely still have some serrated and butcher knives that are... I'm going to say you went for an orifice. Turns out that's this thing's mouth.
Oh, and no.
There's just this...
Wrong orifice.
Oh, so give me a card. She's a killer. Three.
Oh, you can beat that. Surely you can beat a three.
I can't actually kill myself. All of my cards are bigger than a three. So I will take over the scene as the next killer. And I will say that, oh, Jesus. The next scene is in the tunnels beneath, the tunnels that the stowaway was using. You realize after you blow up the food processor that...
leaves a hole to one of the tunnels.
Right, it does. It leads a hole to one of the tunnels, the tunnels that nobody's been using all this yep. time. Who wants to grab characters?
I want Greta.
Okay.
Okay, I'll be Charles.
Okay.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Go ahead.
I think Greta has lost an arm at this point still. Oh, like, she's alive. But I think in that last scene, she lost an arm.
Mm-hmm. All right, Charles so will brandish like, the flamethrower, which he, like, almost immediately, as soon as they're in the tunnels, realizes it's, like, the worst idea. It's, like, way too big for this. Yeah. I'm imagining, like, very narrow yeah. and small, like, service tunnels, so.
We can still make it to the shuttle. We can get off this thing.
We can
both live.
Yeah, we just have to head, that way. And he kind of vaguely gestures.
Yeah. Dave wasn't down here, remember? Maybe this thing can't get down here if it's all technology.
You start hearing a tapping against the pipes. Like, prisoners might communicate. And you realize that the tapping is happening in that same nursery rhyme rhythm. But it's in this moment, Charles, as the first person to have really gotten the tune stuck in your head, that you realize this isn't just like a nursery rhyme-esque tune. That's Morse code that the tapping is occurring in. And it's saying, stay, become us, over and over in Morse code.
I think once the tapping starts, I imagine there was this like moment of like quiet surprise between the two of them, long enough for him to realize, like, you know, go through the message once, and you hear him say, shit, Greta, we have to go. It wants us to become them, but come on. You go first. I'll cover your back.
Yeah, I think we're below the like the, where it should be now, and I start climbing the ladder with like my one arm. Oh, no. Like the best I can. I'm working my way up.
Yeah, the ladder. And Charles is like on the ground at the bottom of the ladder, just like watching their backs.
And I slowly start to turn the crank for the hatch.
Great. And as you turn the crank for the hatch, of course, it once again animates, and it turns into a snake, and it sort of lunges down at you, its tail in your one good hand, and its teeth going towards your neck.
Uh-huh.
Let us... Should we grab even one less card now? Let's, because we're at time, so let's grab your
Greta gets one card.
Great.
Two cards.
Oh, here, let me
I only got two cards.
Let me shuffle all real quick. Sorry. Okay, now grab your cards.
Ah, yes.
Great.
Okay.
So this is against you, Greta. So Jack of Diamonds. Oh no.
Ooh, do you have any survivor points you can use?
I played a lower card. I think this is
I think
Greta
we can
dies.
We can go into final scene.
Let's
yeah.
see.
And the snake goes into your neck, and you can dare it.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
I think Greta just lets go of the ladder, and she just plummets to the bottom of this thing, snake on her thing, and you just hear like a crack as she hits the ground.
I love it. Okay, this is the final scene with the killer.
How does it work?
We didn't really do the mechanics the way I meant to do the mechanics. This is how it's going to work. You're going to be the killer, Aid, and we're going to let whoever feels the most emotionally attached to Charles play Charles. No, I don't like that. Someone has to pick Charles. Let's see. I'm going to make one of my guests do it. It's not going to be me. Does anybody really feel like they want to end with Charles? Who wasn't in the last scene?
I think Rosie should.
Rosie, you want to do it, Rosie?
Sure. I started with Charles. I can bring him out.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Aid, where does the last scene take place?
So I think this is Charles somehow manages to get up through this hatch past this monster, maybe while it was slaughtering Greta in the distraction. And now he is right outside of the, like, he's at the door for to go into the shuttle.
Great.
So he does the door open? I guess not, because there's nothing really powering it anymore, so he starts frantically going at the panel to open it. The panel does not respond, but I think as you approached the shuttle, you would have noticed just like the tiniest crack between the two like door bits.
Okay.
Charles didn't have the shotgun anymore at this point. He had the flamethrower.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. He drops the flamethrower and just shoves his hand in between the cracks and does his best to pull those open to enter
the
shuttle.
Yeah, as you're pulling the door open, you can hear the metal of the door kind of creaking, you know, under the strain of you trying to like open them up. But then slowly the creaking kind of turns into more of a knocking noise, and it's that same pattern as before in Morse code, saying stay, become us.
Fuck, no, not those freaking, I'm not staying here, the last thing I eat is not going to be those freaking cubes! And he just keeps
forcing
the door.
A fit of like rage, you open up the door, and inside the shuttle, it's kind of like a very small pod. It's very dark. Like, none of the electronics in here are on. And you can hear down the hallway, back, you hear knocking again, and it's slowly getting louder.
Okay. And he, hits the button to close. Well, that wouldn't work. He goes to hit the button to close the doors, realizes that's not going to work until he turns the shuttle on, runs towards the front of the shuttle, and frantically starts going at... He's the first officer. He knows how to turn on a shuttle.
Yeah. So I think you are... It takes you some time to find the right switch, but... and, like, as you're, like, frantically looking for the button, you look back and you see that same Dina monster that, like, takes up the whole hallway as it's, like, clawing its way down the hallway. And each time it, like, sticks its hands in the ground, it, like, makes that same knocking noise. And eventually you find the right button and the whole thing kind of turns on.
Great. Then he... slams the button to close the door.
But as you reach for the door button, suddenly, like, this monster is, like, it was going pretty slow before, but now it's, like, right there in the doorway, and it reaches out a hand to snatch Charles.
Okay. So I think the way I would like to do this is thank you for recalling and shuffling. I appreciated that. I screwed up the mechanics a little bit, but that's okay because we're having a great time. And I know the most dramatic way to do this is to just do single card pull. So would the killer please pull a single card? Oh, shit. That is a king of clubs. Would Charles please pull a single card? Oh, no! That's a five of diamonds! Charles, would you end the movie for us, please?
Yes. Charles realizes that he dropped the flamethrower and it's on the opposite side of the monster, but he goes for it anyway. And as he does, that razor comes down.
That's
and
good.
There's that magnificent spray of blood.
Oh.
One of us.
Oh, that was great. Thank you so much for playing Final Girl with me. And thank you, everybody, for sticking out with us. I appreciate it. We went 9 minutes late. We're going to spend a couple more minutes just letting you know what's going on and who we are. I want to let you know, first of all, thank you. Thank you from the Bodhana Group. Thank you from Save Against FearCon. Thank you from the Pants people, the legendary Pants. Let us start. Tell us what's going on in your life and where people can find you. Bob, give us a go.
I'm living that COVID life. I'm working from home, surrounded by the family all the time.
Nice.
Hanging out with Brian online. You find me on the Gamer Assembly. Brian, you can point people at that Discord.
Yeah.
That's where you find me most often. If you live in the South Shore, Massachusetts area, come by Battleground Games and Hobbies, your friendly local game store. I'm the RPG hype man over there.
Awesome. All right. Rosie, who are you? Where can we find you?
Hi, I'm Rosie. You might find me on the Gehenna Gaming Discord or the Monday Night Monster Hearts chat. It's regular size mom. I'd love to say hi. And I hope to see you guys at the next PAX Unplugged or next convention or whatever happens next.
Great. And there's the Gehenna Discord. There's one for Gamer Assembly. Aid, you're up.
I'm Aid, or Ashley. You can find me on the GG Discord. You can also follow me on Twitter. I'll drop a link in the chat. Otherwise, I'm also living that COVID life, so if you reach out to me, I'll probably respond right away, because I'm sitting in front of my computer all the time. Anyways, come watch me on Monster Hearts, our season 2 of our games. Should I not?
No, that's good. You're fine.
Oh, okay, sorry.
Great job.
You shook your head. I'm like,
No.
Season 2 starts on the 26th. Between seasons, we've been doing one-shots, so still come by on Mondays at 7:30 Eastern, and maybe I'll be there.
Okay, great. Natalie, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Natalie Pudim. I'm a professional game master with Charm Person Games. You can book with us at charmpersongames.com. You can see me Monday nights, usually playing Monster Hearts here as Bridget, but during the break, we're going to be playing Ace Adventure, which is a game Brian wrote next week.
And Monday,
I'll be playing the titular Ace Adventure. Wednesday, you can see me on Off the Table running a Glitter Hearts actual play called Return to the Moonlight. And on Thursdays, you can find me back here on Gehenna Gaming with Brian again, doing We're Still Here, a Dream Askew actual play, which the last episode ended in a huge cliffhanger. You need to come see it. And
love it.
I think that's it.
Great.
Brian, where can people find you?
Oh my gosh. Well, you can find me at Brian Liberge on Twitter. You can find me at beerstargames.com. You can go to the link I just dropped in the chat, and you can also find on our Discord, and support me as I support AIDS Action, which is an incredible group in Massachusetts, raising money and doing research to help people with AIDS. And on the 18th, I will be riding on a stationary bicycle running Honey Heist for 3 hours, streaming it live for your amusement, so that you might throw more money at this fantastic group. In fact, some of the people who are here tonight might also be my players for that on the 18th. So that's super awesome. I also have a sale running on beerstargames.com if you want to buy some of my physical products. And of course, we mentioned, Natalie already covered for me, that when I'm going to be back next. So don't miss Monday night when we play Ace Adventure, a game that I will be bringing to Kickstarter soon. It's going to be super fun. So I think we said all the things. Thank you, everybody. And we will, Gehenna Gaming will be back in the morning with more games. Check the schedule below. Bye.
Bye, everybody.
Bye. 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 Where's my cursor? Where's my cursor?